welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
That's right. Give us a call, 866-901-ADAM, 866-901-ADAM. I guess the big topic of today is the day without immigrants. We should, or at least that's what they call it. Give us a call. Call us all day, 866-901-ADAM. When I say all day, I mean stop calling at 10 a.m. or I don't care. But a couple things. First, good morning, Oswaldo. Oswaldo's here this morning. Oswaldo Castillo.
Representing.
Faithful sidekick representing. Comedian Paul Rodriguez is going to be in here, so he can shed some light on this. Also, actor Frank Vincent's calling in from The Sopranos.
Phil Leotardo.
Def Frat guy is going to be doing the news this morning.
He's not here yet, though. He must have been a rough night at the teak house.
Yeah.
Wild night.
Yeah, I probably did like a keg stand through his shoulder.
I'm guessing he hasn't even been to bed.
So he'll be in here. We should tell you that we never really explain what was going on with Rachel Perry news and all that kind of stuff. And there was a lot of moving around. Rachel Perry got a pilot on Fox, and Rachel Perry had to split for a few weeks to do Ozzy. You're putting your nostril right into that microphone. Bresca, usually I yell at you for not putting the mic in the face of the guest. If you don't not put it in Ozzy's face, I'm going to yell at you. There we go. You all right, buddy?
Very, very bad respiration.
That's all right. You guys think he said he had a bad reputation, but he has bad respiration.
Well, listen, I've said it before. He is, if Darth Vader, as we hear the Darth Vader breathing, if Darth Vader and Chewbacca had a child, this would be it. You can't understand him. Thank goodness for Han Solo, a.k.a. Adam Carolla, sitting here nearby to translate for all the rest of us.
That's heavy breathing.
He's got evil intentions like Vader.
Yeah, I think he does. Yeah.
Beard like Chewbacca.
He's trying to take over my wallet. All right, so where the hell was I? Yes, Rachel Perry. Rachel Perry had to go do a pilot, or chose to go do a pilot for Fox, I believe. We wish her well. Also, she wasn't exactly working out over here. So we thought, this timing's pretty good. You got a split for 3 weeks. You may as well make it 3 years. Hell, take the rest of your life off. So that was our take on that. Not a disaster, just not exactly what you call working out. So she's gone, and then we worked Claudia in, and who else did we work in here? It's too early. Yeah, Teresa. The problem with Teresa and Claudia is really Claudia looks more like a Teresa, and Teresa looks more like a Claudia. And you haven't seen them, you guys, but my mind sort of works that way. There's some guys that look like Tim's, and then there's some guys that look like Gerald's, and there's some guys that look like Rob's, and some guys that look like Ed's. And if you screw it up, in my mind, if I decide what you should look like, and I won't just give you one name, you'll have a range. You'll have a few names. But if you go outside of those boundaries, I'll have difficulty remembering your name. If we just have a sort of, look, if we become neighbors and hang out every Sunday after a couple of years, eventually I'm going to get it down. But if it's just one of these things where we pass each other in the hall every 2 or 3 weeks and you're a name that looks like what you're not, you're screwed.
Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Well, that's an interesting point. What do you think? What do you think you look like? What name should you have? You could be Adam is not accurate for you at all. You know, you've got a swarthy way about you. What about Carl?
Yeah, but Carl doesn't exactly say swarthy either. Although,
I don't know. It seems like a man, because you always got a beard,
well,
3-day growth and stuff.
There are certain names that become sort of like crescent wrenches. Please tell me you know what a crescent wrench is.
Sure.
You do?
Yeah.
What is it?
I don't know.
Oh, sad.
I just wanted to agree.
Sad.
A crescent wrench is the one, let me guess. No, that's not. I know that's not right.
Buttery, flaky. No. Crescent wrench is an adjustable wrench. It's that one that you sort of can roll your thumb in, open it, and close the mouth of the thing.
I thought that was a monkey wrench.
Now, monkey wrench would be more like the pipe wrench. That's where the jaw drops down.
Oh, you know
what I'm talking?
Sure, more, yeah.
The vertical cousin of the crescent wrench, you know? Yeah, but it's kind of the same thing. Anyway, the point is this. Point is, there's certain names are like crescent wrenches. They'll work for just, you know, Steve can kind of work, you know, could be a feminine gay guy, or it could be a senator named Steven something, you know, there's certain, and then there are other ones like Seth that have almost no range.
Mm-hmm.
They're box end wrenches. They're fixed. They only fit one thing.
Cody
only fits one thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, if you don't look like your name, I'm going to have trouble with you for a while. That's how it works. So anyway, where was I? Yes, Rachel is gone. Teresa and Claudia were the two girls we tried out, and we like them both a lot. So it's a very tough decision, but I've decided to ask Dave to leave. We're keeping Claudia and Teresa.
What?
As long as it's your fucking shine box.
I know you thought it was going to be between them, but they're both really good.
I see. Well,
and they pretty up the place a little bit, too.
By the way, a lot of people, you say people don't know what they look like. I've gotten many emails from chums who have gone on the online and looked them up, respectively. Both like their looks.
Yeah, they're both
attractive, different from one another.
They're both attractive. And here's the thing. We're trying to make that decision. And we should have a decision for you soon, but until then, we have Deaf Frat Guy. Who's not bad in the looks department either. Ron? Ron, you called in the program?
Yeah, how you doing?
Good, how you doing?
Okay.
All right.
I was just wanting to touch base on you guys about, I feel that, you know, all this immigration thing turned around to be a good thing because, I mean, God knows we can't, you know, just deport that many people, you know, simultaneously. It's just going to be impossible.
Yeah, we're going to have to make two trips. That's the way I look at it.
At least three. But I really believe if they want to prove that they can be good citizens, you know what I'm saying? I think that the men, because most of the Hispanic people are very traditional, and the men work and the women stay at home. I don't know if you know that or not.
Oh, but listen, I live in Southern California. I live in Los Angeles. I am Mexican.
Oh, okay. All right, well, then they should let them go into the military for a period of 5 years.
5 years.
If they serve their country successful and get an honorable discharge, they can get their citizenship like that.
Yeah.
You know? And and their wives, too, being at the fact that they'll probably be married, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that they should do that because, I mean, we have a lot of broken families here anyway. Like, the kids are citizens. And, and the parents aren't.
All right, so you're saying funnel them into the military.
Well, not actually funnel them, but, you know, the ones that are younger and, you know, and stronger and, you know, and, you know, a lot of them are bilingual already. I mean, I feel it would be an excellent way to ease up some of the problems.
All right. Thank you, Ron from Phoenix. Yeah, here's you can't put foreign nationals into this country's military, though. I think that's the problem. You don't want to have our entire military become Mexico's military. That's not a bad idea. Look, here's the deal. Poor people go into the military anyway. That's the way it works. When you get out of high school, you have... Here's how your choices go, basically. College... Then after that, military. Then after that, just go to work. And then after that, prison. And then junior college. That's actually in terms of bringing shame to your family. Junior college is just edged out by prison. If there's a mother whose kid is in prison and a mother's kid's in junior college, the one who's in prison is going to look down her nose.
Well,
the one who's in junior
maybe
college.
This is what we should do. Instead of just reject, like, all these people, what we should do is take a note from Survivor and start eliminating people that don't contribute to society. If we need the space, get rid of the Cato Kalins, the Buttafucos, you know,
I would
these
be
people.
Fine with that. Well, look, as I've said many times, it's, you know, way less than 2% of society that destroys it for the rest of us.
That's right.
The ones where everything has to be childproof. There's no jar. You can't get into a thing of vitamin C without using a cold chisel. You know what I mean? You do that thing where you just, sometimes you'll get up in the middle of the night at 4 a.m. Maybe you did a little boozing. You essentially tilted a few back on a Saturday night. You get up, It's 4:30 in the morning. You have cotton mouth. You have a headache. So you stumble into the bathroom. You want to get. You're going to put in. You're going to have a couple Tylenol, a couple aspirin, and a couple swigs of water. You don't want to turn the light on because you don't want to dilate your pupils. So you do that thing where you feel around. You grab the thing. You grab the thing of Tylenol or whatever, and you start struggling with it for a while, and then you're trying to sort of line up the arrows and all that kind of stuff, and then you think to yourself, there's no goddamn kid in this house.
Yeah, and then you're frustrated, and then you start to get really frustrated, and then your anxiety,
right.
You rip the lid off, and then
right. Things
three
go flying
dozen
everywhere.
Fly all over.
John?
Yeah?
John, you say I'm wrong about the Crescent Ranch?
A Crescent Ranch is an open-ended ranch that looks like a crescent. An adjustable wrench can be a crescent wrench, but an adjustable wrench is not a crescent wrench. If you go and buy yourself a set of crescent wrenches, you'll see.
My God, does your daughter have an eating disorder? The way you talk to her. Do you hear that tone?
Hey, I'm talking nice to you right now.
Yeah, I know. What do you do? Teach shop, P.E.?
No, I grew up with old Chevys.
Do you have a daughter that hates you?
No, I don't. I have boys, and I'm training them right.
Oh, boy. One's gay, one's thrown up right now. I guarantee it. Now, listen, a Crescent Ranch, Crescent is a brand name. Crescent is a brand name like Crescent Ranch is like what Q-tip is to Cotton Swab.
Crescent is a shape. That's why if you ever worked in a shop when you were a kid...
Listen, look it up there, Michelle. Adjustable ranch and a crescent ranch are the same ranch.
It's not the same.
All right, well...
It's not the same. You're an idiot.
Oh, I'm an idiot.
Go out, go.
What do you do now? What do you do now for a living, genius?
I want to go to. I'm a teacher.
Oh, what a shocker. Remember I said shop or P.E.? What a shocker. You're molding youth. And you're teaching in Los Angeles? Have fun
yourself.
Talking to a group of empty chairs this morning.
Get yourself a set of crescent
What do you
wrenches?
Do with that $41,000 you make a year? What do you do when you have that kind of money? Have a boat or an RV?
No, I upgrade the cardboard box I live in, okay?
Yeah. Oh, do your sons hate your guts. Wrenches. What do you teach? What topic do you teach?
I teach writing.
I find that hard to believe.
Well, it's true.
What school are you at?
I am independent.
You're an independent teacher?
That's correct.
How does that work? You're
well,
a tutor?
I go to different institutions for specialty courses.
Oh, the kids must be delighted when you walk into the classroom. That's a number two pencil. No, but number two is not it. Are you stupid?
Out.
It's not a mechanical pencil.
Out.
It's a number two pencil.
When they walk out, they're better than when they came in. Just like when
right.
I hang up, you will be better than when I called.
All right, we will look up. We'll look up Crescent Ranch and we'll look up Adjustable Ranch.
Good.
All right, did you find anything?
It's hard to decide. It's hard to define. Yeah, there is. I will say this. The leader in the clubhouse is Carolla on this one because I looked it up, I'm just saying this. There's a copyright logo next to the word crescent. There's a copyright logo next to the word crescent.
Right, by the way, what a fine imparter of wisdom John is. Starts yelling at you when you get about halfway into your thing. Well, I will see. So we'll say that the leader. No, you're not.
See,
jackass. Shut up for a second.
Let me
and
tell
listen.
You something. Let me just say this much. It says right here. I'm looking on this thing, Wikipedia, .org. This thing that provides definition. It's basically the encyclopedia of the online. It says here, Crescent is an adjustable open-ended wrench made by Crescent Tool and Horseshoe Company.
Thank you, J.O.
That looks like Carolla's right.
What do you have to say, John?
I'm saying walk into any auto shop.
I walk in any. What did I just say?
Ask him for a crescent wrench and see what they hand you.
Yeah, right. A guy with a GED barely speaks in English.
It's going to look like a crescent.
Listen, why don't you get on something called a computer and go look up crescent wrench and adjustable wrench, and you'll see that I'm 100% right, jack off.
You can't fix a computer with a crescent wrench.
All right, see, now you're screwing around because you're wrong. Just apologize to me and we'll move on.
You are wrong.
I'm wrong?
You are wrong.
It says here.
It says
Crescent
it right
Tool
there.
And Horseshoe Company.
Hold on.
Supporting it.
Listen, he just told you the definition.
I have no idea one way or the other which it is. I looked it up online.
John,
he doesn't know because he has his nose so far up your
John.
Butt.
John. Oh, yeah. Look, he just read it off the computer. You want him to read it again?
Hey, I want you to go into the real world and ask any mechanic out there for a crescent wrench and see what they hand you.
All right, so here's the whole thing. Because I defined it spot on, I'm wrong because in the real world, that's what it is. So it's like if I called, if I said, well, what's a marijuana cigarette? It's marijuana rolled up into a cigarette. And he's saying, no, if you go in the world, it's called a joint. It's called a doobie. So I'm wrong for my spot on definition of it. Oh, I'm so angry at you, John.
You are separating yourself from the people because you will not.
By the way, I described a crescent wrench. It's a ridiculous radio show. I described it to a T. Where did I get that definition? From Webster's when I was 14?
From a garage.
Of course I got it from a garage. I just described the stupid thing. John, just apologize, you retard.
I can't apologize.
Oh, shut up. What a J-O. The only thing that's... I'll tell you why I'm... Right. Let me say this, John. Go
home and get your f***ing shine box.
Look, here's the thing. If you're going to argue, that's fine. You don't have to become insulting. You don't have to go like any idiot will tell you. But fine. If you want to do that, that's your prerogative. But then when you're wrong, you have to own up to it. I said a crescent wrench was a company name, like what Q-tip is to Cotton Suave, number one. I was right. Number two, I said it's just another name. It's a brand name for an adjustable wrench. That's exactly what it is. What a J-O.
Well, some people are upset about our immigration standards.
That's
some
right.
About the war. Carolla gets hot under the collar about the crescent wrench.
Nick?
So be it.
Nick, are you here to support me?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
I am a diesel mechanic, and that teacher is wrong.
His name is John Crescent.
Yes. Shaped like a crescent. What a jackass. Thank you, Nick. You're salt of the earth.
Not a problem.
I'm this close to sending you out a Hooters gift certificate.
Sweet.
Yeah, but I didn't quite cross into that territory. But this close. This close. Peter?
Hey, what's up, man?
What's up?
Hey, Carol, I want to tell you to go home and get your shine box, but I think that Tinkerbell John that just called, go home and get his effing, he's a J-O.
Yeah, well, look, it's essentially, thank you, it's welching on a bet. When you get, when you make an argument, if I said to you, Dave, look, I happen to know that the Lakers are going to win the series, and they lose, then I owe you. Whatever the bet is, I owe you. When you say to somebody, Kareem. I'm trying to think of a non sports related thing. But when you say crescent wrench is this or an open end wrench, when you're wrong and you don't give it up to the person, that's welching on a bet. You
that's
didn't
right.
bet $5. It's emotionally welching. One would argue it's even more impactful.
Well, then he attacked me.
Yeah.
My nose is up your butt because I looked that up on the online. I have no idea which it is either way.
I know, Tony.
Hey, Adam.
What's happening?
That guy's a jerk off.
Thank you. What a delight. Oh, when that guy comes walking in your home to tutor your child.
That condescending tone.
It's going to be great.
Crescent wrench comes from the fact that it's shaped like a crescent.
Yes, walk into any garage. All right.
Hey, I was just wondering if maybe you could take the pulse of the audience and see what they think about Teresa and Claudia.
All right, we'll do that. In the 9 o'clock hour, people should call in. Now, go ahead, Tony.
I said I would have to put a vote in for Teresa as long as she's not a ultra liberal or from Canada.
Mm-hmm.
I can't stand Claudia's laugh. She might be good on the eyes, but I don't see her.
You don't see her. Mm-hmm.
Teresa sounds a lot better. I would have to say.
Okay, you like so you're casting your vote for Teresa.
Absolutely.
All right, Tony. We'll take that under close consideration. Thanks, Tony.
All right.
Take care. Real quick now, John.
I think in L.A. they call it a crescent wrench, but it's a adjustable wrench. This guy's a dip. Where'd he come from, L.A.?
I know. Yeah, he must have. Wait a minute. I'm from L.A. All right.
He's shaping young minds.
You know what a crescent wrench is, man. You can send me the Hooters because you're right all the way. This guy's a teacher teaching the wrong stuff.
Should we give a Brusca? Do we have a Hooters gift certificate for John? He's doing a lot of ass kissing.
All right.
All right. Hang on, John.
Thank you, sir.
We need to take a break.
I also want to hear, too, about your trip to the Kimmel show on Friday night.
Lance?
How you doing, Ace? Just want to call and say, hey, sad to hear Richard Perry gone, but you know what? I was tired of the Canadian.
Yeah.
Two, she knew nothing about nothing, sports, nothing. She didn't know where the hell the streets were over there. And three, when she put down Gene Simmons, that was it. I remember listening that day. Gene Simmons is a god to young men. He laid with 20,000 women, and she was nothing cocky, like if she was too good for him.
Yeah.
So I hope the door doesn't hit on her behind, and she's going to fail in her show anyways. I love your show.
Thanks, Lance.
The Pittsburgh Steelers fan over there, I'm a 49er.
All right.
On Ace.
All right. Take care, buddy. You know, Rachel's got herself a pilot on Fox. I was thinking to myself, I thought, should I put my Carolla pox? When I put the pox, when I dust off my finger fate, it's a windfall for whatever I do it for. Like, if I put a curse on anything, it always turns out great. The last band I officially put a curse on was No Doubt. And also Gwen from No Doubt. And that was about 11 or 12 years ago. You've heard of the band?
I have.
They have sold some records since that time.
Sort of fringy. They would be much bigger, though.
I'm sure. There's a handful of things I put a pox on, I put a curse on, I've given the evil eye to over the years, and they always come out, they do gangbusters. So, A, I should start putting a curse on my own work. And then, B, I should have my curse out for hire. That's the way I look at it. The Hollywood Insider should have me just look at a list of new shows, potential pilots, and my curse will go the highest bidder. I put a curse on your show. It's going to number one.
Top 10.
Yeah. We will take ourselves a break. Oswaldo is here today. Comedian, what movie did you review today for us, Oswaldo?
A Stick It?
No, he's just saying that.
Oh, okay. Oh. Very defiant on this Today Without Immigrants. Comedian Paul Rodriguez is coming in here. Frank Vincent, Phil Leotardo from The Sopranos. Def Frack Guy is going to do the news. All that coming up on The Adam Carolla Show.
Without a home, but not without a star.
Kind of like this song.
Free.
Neil Diamond, I'm trying to think. Trying to think of your sort of top names. Barry Manilow's up there. Neil Diamond's up there. You don't exactly get onto the mountaintop with a bullhorn and scream that you're a Neil Diamond fan or a Barry Manilow fan or an ABBA fan. But yet, if you're driving in your car and it comes on, you probably don't change. You don't switch the channel.
Yeah, it's definitely something to be ashamed of. I know what you're saying. It's also, but the other problem with Neil Diamond is that his fans are overzealous about their love of Neil Diamond. It's the same thing with the Grateful Dead. I always have said, people say, oh, the Grateful Dead is terrible. What a terrible band. They're not terrible. They're fine. It's that their fans go so far that they make you want to stay away from the entire experience.
That's funny. I was over at Kimmel's house last night eating a mountain of linguine. Jimmy cooks like, you know, he cooks like a heavy set 60-something-year-old Italian woman. I mean, it's just like seeing my grandmother in there with those funky glasses and the hair, funky hair and the smock on. He was, I don't know why we got in this discussion, but we tried to figure out who the most ravenous fans were. And I basically said Tori Amos. I know it sounds insane. Hear me out. I've been to Tori Amos shows before. Tori Amos has ravenous fans. They're Tori-philes. They would all drink the Kool-Aid as Dickie from the Boston's, who was also there. Actually, everyone was there but Dave Damashek.
Yeah,
eating
what
lovely
gives?
Linguine. Jimmy said I probably shouldn't bring it up to you, so I'll just leave it at that. The point is, your wife Cindy then chimed in. Yes, she was there too. Yes, Mo and your dad and a couple guys you went to high school with all agreed with me. Now, Dickie said, you know, he agreed because he used to, I don't know, they had the same manager or something. He said, Tori Amos, these people, not crazy, they don't dress up like Tori Amos when they go to concerts. But if she said it's time for everyone to drink the poison Kool-Aid halfway into the concert, they would all do it. Whereas we decided that the Grateful Dead fans were there for the experience. Fans of the band, but fans of the experience. Wanted to go there, smoke a doobie, and kick a hacky sack around with like-minded tards. Do you know what I'm saying?
I guess I do. But the entire lifestyle then, I mean, listening to the band then seems to require that you devote yourself 24 hours a day to the lifestyle.
But I guess it's an interesting thing, and not at all what we planned on talking about, which is there's some people that are fans of the experience and some people that are fans of the person.
I hear you.
And I think for Neil, it's the person, and for Barry, it's the person.
I've never been to a Kiss show, but that seems like a pretty hardcore crowd, too. They paint their
yes.
Face
somebody took the citizenship test. We'll talk. Oh, my other guy dropped off. He was a Crescent Ranch dealer from the Bay Area. what name is that? Inderjeet?
Hey, buddy.
Inderjeet?
Yes, man. How are you doing?
Good. How you doing?
No, man, I'm just trying to go to work here, man. This is very bad. This guy, Dave Damashek, needs to be quiet.
Yes, he does.
Man, this guy is so stupid. Why he yells this, that? I don't want to hear this. I want to... it is the Adam Carolla show, man. I don't want to hear this guy going on about...
Blah,
whatever.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, that's a
blah,
good point,
blah.
Inderjeet.
Hey, tell that guy to shut up.
I think you may have just have done that. Did you recently... take the citizenship test?
Yes. Me and my brother, he's been here for much longer than I have been, but I've just taken it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have that citizenship test in my left hand. We're thinking about asking Big Tan and Ozzy a couple questions.
I like Ozzy. I like he's got a very good accent, man. I can understand what he is saying perfectly.
Yeah, that's amazing. No one else can. He said thank you. Tad, you are...
Tad, he looks like a very big Pop-Tart. He likes to eat that tart.
Yes.
I have a grocery store. I see Tad there, man. He'll come and eat everything I pay him.
Well, hold on a second.
It's a hilarious bet this guy's doing.
Inderjeet's
Inderjeet.
Phone's breaking up. Yeah, I think he said Tad looked like a big Pop-Tart. Certainly got the width part down, but if you look at him profile, I don't think so. Sergio's back. All right, now what are we doing here, Brusca? You want to talk? You want to talk a little Spanish national anthem? Hold on one second, Sergio.
Hey, how you doing, Adam?
You're officially licensed Crescent Wrench dealer.
We used to deal with Crescent Wrenches when I worked. First job out of high school, worked at Bay Bridge Hardware, Industrial Hardware Supply.
What do you got for me, Sergio?
Well, I was going to let you know that we had this not only the wrench. You are totally correct, Adam, about the wrench itself.
Thank you.
A brand, that's without a doubt.
Thank you.
But the other thing I wanted to ask you about was about this Leno thing. Are you dealing with our friend Jay Leno on a car deal? Because he is world-renowned in the Lamborghini. You know?
Yes. Jay Leno, by the way, it's obviously it's a Burr and Kimmel saddle.
I was just going to say.
My buddy.
Was Jay Leno there last night at the big dinner that everyone was invited to but Dave?
He wasn't, but his name came up. I realized there was trouble because of a third party that went out with Jimmy on Saturday and may have spoken about Leno to him, a real estate person.
Hmm.
Yeah. It's not, I don't want to get into it, but he was renewed with Leno vigor. Kimmel was on Sunday when I saw him. I saw Kimmel on Friday when I did his television show.
Right.
And then I saw him Sunday when everyone but Dave Damashek was invited over to eat pasta. It's good stuff, right, Brusca?
Awesome. You were there, Brusca?
Tad.
Yeah,
have you ever had better linguine in class?
I know Tad wasn't
invited.
It was
so delish. My two cousins were there and their friends.
Shut Mike, up. Were you really there?
How about that endive salad to die
still,
for?
I'm still full.
Ozzy. Ozzy's full too.
I'll forward you the email from Kimmel inviting me if you want to see it.
Yeah, get him that. And Billy, how about that squid he threw on the barbecue? I bet you never had it barbecued before, huh?
The char broiling on the squid was just
It's out of this world.
Yeah,
it was to die for. Yeah,
the garlic bread too.
Yeah,
I forgot to mention that.
By the way, your brother and his fiance, they seem like a delight. Feel free to bring him by the station at some point.
Doctor will be in.
All right, it's a good man.
This is an outrage.
Brian, linguinis and clams over at Kimmel's last night. Great, huh? Good stuff.
A delight, truly.
Yeah. I don't know if you took any home. I think he sent Dickie home with some, but I don't know if you brought any of that home. It's great stuff.
One or two bags.
All right. I got to remind producer Angie, take it out of the car before it spoils. You know, sometimes you bring stuff home, you throw it into the car, and then you smell something a few weeks later. All right, anyway, should have been there, Dave. Where the hell were we now? What were we talking about?
Ozzy's ready to do the anthem.
Oh, yeah, Ozzy. Ozzy is going to do our national anthem. Ozzy, yep. We've all heard it sung in Spanish over the last few. Yeah, this is it. I don't like any song that starts this way, no matter what the language is, where everyone acts like they're just sort of warming up. I like the song to start. I don't like everyone to go, hey, whoa. It'd be like watching a football game start with a kickoff, and guys sort of, half the guys are jogging down the field, and the rest are still stretching where they are. I like it to start. You know what I mean? I like it to start. I don't like them sort of warm in, hey, whoa. Kind of, the one thing I did notice about this version of the song, you don't get mired in this in the really confusing words. And you really just start to listen to the melody of it, and you go, oh, it's a nice, sounds like a nice classical melody.
Sort of washes over you.
Yeah, normally when you hear, you're seeing a camera sweep across super sweaty-faced black guys, and you're up on your feet wringing your terrible towel. Mm-hmm. You know, here's the problem, actually. The national anthem is only, I only associate it with a pre-sporting events, and all I want them to do is get the F through it so we can get to kickoff or tip off or whatever we're trying to get to. So if you think about it, it's in an unfair place. You know what I mean? You want to power through it. You don't associate it with anything good. It's the meter maid of songs. The only time you ever see a meter maid is when they're effing you. There's no context other than a sort of negative one. I know it sounds like a tough comparison, but I mean, every time I hear the Star Spangled Banner, all I want to do is get through. Come on, let's go. Let's get to it. Let's get to the kickoff.
Nothing more vain and narcissistic than the singer who holds you hostage, though. Holds the audience, the crowd hostage by doing the very long one.
Right. That's why it's important.
Chop, chop.
It's important to get people that can't really sing to do it.
Yes.
When you get Whitney Houston, we get someone who has pipes and it's... Oh, 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 oh. That's bad.
Yeah.
I want people that have just a little touch of Down syndrome. Who are just going to power right through it. Not the blessed. All right, speaking of Down syndrome, Ozzy.
Yep.
You ready to sing our national anthem for us?
Yep, I'm ready.
All right. Wait. You ready? We got to start with the music. You're going to do it in English, all right?
Yep. As I can you see.
Hold on a second. You're doing this in English, right?
Yep.
Is that what that was?
English.
Okay.
Yeah, he wants to prove that he's acclimated himself. All right. He doesn't do this song in Spanish.
He doesn't. Show me the finger.
All right, so we... yeah, that's the key. We'll
show
cue you.
Show me the finger.
All right,
Ozzy.
You ready? Here we go. Ozzy, look for the finger. There you go.
Wait a minute.
Hold on. It starts right at the beginning.
You got to point to him. You got to point to him.
Right away, as soon as you hear the music, go right to it.
Bruska, yeah, but he told you, show him the finger. Show him the finger.
You're pointing to the back of his neck, by the way, Bruska. You got to point where his eyes are. He's not a horse.
One more time. As soon as you hear the music.
His eyes are in front of him, though, Bruska. You're pointing his ear. All right, you ready? Ozzy, over here. Look for Bruska's finger. Hold on. All right, I'll do the thing. 2, 3, 4.
All I can you see by the worldly light, what so proudly we hailing in the twin last gleaming, was so brightly spring bright, ether through the period fight, oil lamp are washing where so gallantly streaming. And rock red grande for the air gave a proof through the night and the flood while still is there. All side of the star is brand red banner waving. Oh, in the land the free and the home
Yeah.
Wow.
Roseanne did a better job. Nice job, buddy.
Stirring.
I never do it before.
Yeah, no ass, Sherlock. I mean, Sergio. All right, we're going to take ourselves a break. We will continue on our theme with the big day without the immigrants. Comedian Paul Rodriguez is going to come in here. Paul Rodriguez, does he have the son who's the extreme sports skateboarder guy? Yes, I look for Tad to these answers. Yes, he does. They're doing the guy's like an Extreme Games champion on skateboard. What a country
wow.
this is. Yeah.
Never
yeah.
heard that.
Yeah. I saw it on some news show. Anyway, we'll ask him about that. I think they're going to be doing a TV show about it. Frank Vincent from The Sopranos, Phil Leotardo, Def Frat Guys doing the news for us today. Also, Ozzy's got his movie review all coming up after this.
Louis Louis. Oh, no. Me gotta go. Ay, 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 I said, Louie, Louie, oh, baby, me got to go.
Mm-hmm.
My little girl, wait up for me.
The frat guy, what's happening?
What's happening, bro? Organizer for the unprecedented.
Hold on. We're not doing the news just yet, but we appreciate you looking for the finger.
Well, I'm just trying to do a good job.
No, I understand. Def Rat Guy, we know him as Jason, you know him as Maverick. He's known to his other brothers at the Teak House, 50-year senior over at USC. He's looking for a gig. What's your major over there at SC?
Communications major, so it would really be a perfect fit.
Right. He's looking to catch on here at the radio station. We've tried him out doing some traffic. I think he did some weather, maybe some financial news. Now, why not let him have a crack at the news? So we'll be up in a few minutes with that. I just wanted to say hi to you and introduce you to the people. That's all.
I just wanted to say one thing. I'm getting a little PO'd at having to come in here so early.
Well, I know Tad feels the same way, but... See, that's the problem. It's not going to change. I know you when you're at college, you just don't have your first class before noon, and you're fine. That's not the way the real world is, Def Frat Guy. You have to get up. You can't be hungover.
Bro. You're yeah. a really powerful guy. Why can't you get the showtime changed to 10 or 11?
Yeah.
Not
maybe,
a bad idea.
Maybe you're right. Move it to like 10:45, Mike.
Hi. I just wanted to say, Ozzy... was funny as hell with that Star Spangled Banner version.
Yeah. The beauty of Ozzy is he was serious as cancer with that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he was, but it was still, I'm in my work truck and I'm rolling, dying laughing here.
What do you do, Mike? You deliver something?
No, I'm an exterminator.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
There's a glamorous gig.
Not really.
I was kidding. Do you have, you walk around with one of those Hudson sprayers?
Yeah.
I like that thing. That's that thing that has the hopper and you pump the top up on it.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're a neighbor looking over your fence and you're obscured, add it. You know the old lady? Oh,
hey, man,
I should say masturbating.
I have reason to look. I can look like I'm doing that. Some of these chicks out here, man, they don't care who you are. They lay in their backyard naked.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Not a bad gig. I will say this. If you're going to have a crappy job, do it on the road. The day passes much quicker.
Oh, most definitely.
Don't got the man leaning on you all day.
Yeah, I've had 1,000 horrible jobs in my life, and maybe the worst is when I worked at a travel agency. Me and 22 female travel agents, and these are the worst people ever born. One day, I'm going to make some sort of a-hole C-word pyramid, and I'm going to work it out. Obviously, publicist resides at the top of the a-hole C-word pyramid. I'm just doing a-hole for the guys and the C-word for the gals. Publicist is at the top. Then the second tier, you have like attorneys. Somewhere between, yeah, so travel agent, female travel agent is right up there.
I was going to say, if it was you and 22 women, I would think that might be a good thing.
No. Just a bunch of bitter coozes. Travel agents are women that are sort of kept women. They're yentas whose husbands make enough money so that they don't really have to work. So work becomes a hobby. So then they come to work and overcompensate for the fact that they don't really have to work. And they would just yell at me who sat in the back of the travel agency and stared at a clock.
I always wanted to marry a stewardess because then they go on the road a lot of the time, so you have time for yourself. And then, two, you also get to travel wherever you want to go, you know, for free.
Right.
That's the deal. Everyone gets to travel for free in the family. It's awesome.
Used to be that way. I don't know if it's still that way. I think maybe those were during the salad days of the airlines, but maybe it is. All right, we got to take ourselves a break. What, who do you want to talk to? Oh, Frank, was that what the finger was? Brussels gave me the finger now. Listen, wipe that finger off before you give it to me after you give it to Ozzy. We're going to take a quick break. Frank Vincent, Phil Leotardo from The Sopranos going to be calling in. Also, Def Frat Guy delivering the news. And then comedian Paul Rodriguez is out there. Talk to him. We have a specially themed day. Take a quick break. Be right back after this.
Maybe he was a homo. Felt there was no one he could talk to about it.
We can't have him here in our social club no more.
How much more betrayal can I take?
There's been confirmation through the grapevine. Vito was seen in a car with a man.
When he was always talking about greasing the union, who knew that's what he meant?
I don't want to get graphic beyond that. The idea of it repulses me so much.
I can't believe I stuck up for him. I feel like I've been stabbed in the heart.
Cornhole and cuffers like married my cousin. He should fucking die.
There you go. Frank Vincent from Sopranos, which we watched last night. Dave was asking Frank's on hold. We'll put him on in a second. You know, Miss Phil Leotardo. Dave, was you watched last night's episode?
Yeah, well, listen. I think this, and I know I'm sure people say, oh, it makes me gay. But listen. Johnny Cakes, who Vito goes off to New Hampshire, you know, he goes, mm-hmm. he's the guy flipping the things, working the griddle, making the nice Johnny Cakes mm-hmm. pancakes and the sausage, everything. Why is Johnny Cakes interested in Vito? Johnny Cakes is a cool guy. He rides a Harley, you know, mm-hmm. he's a fireman, he's got the cool handlebar mustache. What's he want with the fat guy?
I had a friend for many years that was a very heavy-set gay guy, and he had no difficulties at all picking up good-looking gay guys who looked like bathing suit models.
Hmm.
There's a weird little sub-cult that's into the teddy bears. Or just bears.
That's interesting. I guess you could make the same argument, though, for why are there this string of women that are supposedly interested in Tony Soprano?
Yeah.
He's well, that's not an attractive man.
Yeah, but that has to do with power, and that has to do with, you know, charisma and stuff. This is almost just a weird physical thing that, and this is why I'm going to tell my son, listen, I mean, I'm going to wait until he's like 8 or 9, but if you're going to get laid, no, I'm not saying he gets laid at 8 or 9, that's when I have the conversation with him. Better just to pick a team. And don't try to be all things to all people. Just go ahead and cultivate a look. Go punk, go rockabilly, or be morbidly obese. They will, and go gay. Mm-hmm. You can be a fat guy. If you're a fat guy and straight, you don't get laid. If you're a fat guy and gay, you can get laid.
Hmm.
There's a weird chubby chaser sect that will be in you. It's not the lion's share of the gays. Maybe it's only 2%, but either way, that translates into millions of guys for you.
Yeah, gay Bill.
Bill, gay Bill, board up. Pre-op, board-op, Bill. Am I making this up?
Not at all. Not at all. Not at all. There's plenty.
Tell engineer Ron to shut up back there, would you?
Yeah, yeah. My friend is Hector. He is so hot looking, but yes. he will look at these bare men and say, "That is the hottest guy." And I'm flummoxed because I'm like, "Why don't you pick me?"
Right.
But
is flummox a gay position?
Yeah, that is.
That'd be my gay position. What'd you guys do? We did reverse cowboy and flummoxed.
Ace, we got to talk about it. We got the Phil Leotardo waiting.
Yes, sorry.
But let me just say this. Before that, we got it. Maybe the next break or something. I want to know what you would do if your son did, in fact, turn out to be gay.
All right. We'll talk about that. Frank Vincent?
Adam, you're getting on my nerves today.
Sorry, buddy. What happened?
I mean, all this flummox and all this stuff, you guys. I mean, what are you turning into over here?
That's a good point.
You know, I mean, this guy married my cousin. He embarrassed me personally.
He disgraced a family.
He disgraced me. Now you were talking about fat guys and like a million guys can go out with them. Take it easy here.
Sorry, Frank.
What are you, a fanook?
Don't be a fanook.
I always, now, you know, it's nice watching The Sopranos every Sunday night, knowing that 9 hours later we'll be speaking in the flesh. I now watch with renewed excitement. I look for all your scenes. I try to think about what you're saying and what you're doing.
That's good.
It is a surreal experience for me. But so gay veto still going strong.
Brokeback Mafia.
Yeah. Well, Dave Damashek over here was saying that scene seemed very Brokeback Mountain-esque.
It was straight out of the movie, wasn't it?
Right.
Was that intentional?
Well, you gotta give David Chase credit. I mean, he is really very current, considering that was shot a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And I mean, he's always been current, and I don't know how he does it, but he just has an imagination that gets that and that works for him.
Did Chase see Brokeback Mountain, or is it just weird coinkydink that it was done that way?
I don't think it was out at that time. I think it might have been coming out.
Right.
And he probably is up to date on everything that's happening. And he took a shot.
Let me remind everybody, as I was just looking down at Frank Vincent's card, Do the Right Thing, Jungle Fever, Raging Bull, Casino, and Goodfellas. Could you imagine being in those three projects? That's a career. I mean, to me, Goodfellas, one of my favorite movies of all time. Raging Bull, way up there. And Casino, underrated. I always say, go back and watch Casino. I watched it in its entirety a few weeks back. You'll not be disappointed at all.
Those movies all come back. You know, they're all like 10-year later movies. Everybody realizes what they were. Like The Godfather. You know, I keep watching. Casino's one of those movies. Because Goodfellas didn't happen until 10 years later. I mean, everybody, it didn't do great in box office. I mean, but then all of a sudden, go home and get your shine box. You know, it became like a catchword. Everybody loved it.
Hadn't heard that
one.
Go
home and get your f***ing shine box.
And don't forget the t-shirts, frankvincent.com.
That's right, and the coffee mugs, too.
The coffee mugs.
And the book, The Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Man.
Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Doing terrific, and I'm really happy that you guys are giving me the plug on it, and I really appreciate it.
Sure, but you know how this relationship works. It's a two-way street. We give you a couple plugs. You give us a little tip on what's coming up on The Sopranos.
Speaking of which...
Well,
Let me just say this. Let me ask you this. Phil Leotardo, who do you think he would rather kill, and who is he going to kill? Vito or Johnny Sack? Gay Vito, who betrayed his relative, or Johnny Sack, who cried like a woman, and now you take over his family?
I don't think that he wants to kill Johnny Sack. I think that he probably wants to kill Vito.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I know, but I'm not going to tell you.
Right. Yeah. Well, you know, they don't get too uptight about it. We spoke to Gay Vito, Joseph Cannoli.
Yeah. Yeah, let's call
it, yeah. Yeah. I tell you, the guy's last name, you put on 10 pounds just saying his last name. Really, sounds like a lovely pastry, like an Italian pastry.
He's a good guy, Joe.
He is a good guy. We spoke to him last Friday, and he basically said, look out for the relationship between him and the guy who flips the Johnny Cakes.
Yeah, the fireman, yeah.
Which means maybe he said a little too much, but... How does that work? I know you guys aren't supposed to talk, but there's a trade-off, right? I mean, you want to go out and promote. People want little morsels of information. Have you ever been reprimanded? Has anyone ever pulled you aside?
No, I've never been reprimanded. I don't go too far. I say to you this, that Phil, you know, Phil was, like you said, he swallowed his pride once. He's not going to do it again.
Mm.
So he's got an agenda, and more than likely, he's going to fulfill that agenda. We'll see what happens.
All right.
But you're in for a massive, massive, surprises. A lot of things are going to happen towards the end. What do we got? That was 9 last night, so we got 3 more.
No, was it 9? We already at 9?
Or 8?
Yeah, it feels more like 7 or 8 than 9.
Might be 8.
Yeah.
Maybe 8, so we got 4 more to go. And
Right.
There's a lot can happen in 4 hours.
Well, it does feel to me like The Sopranos has been sort of building up like like a zit that was ready to pop. You know, they've had a lot of B and C stories going around and a lot of stuff all moving toward a head. And that is going to come in the upcoming weeks, obviously.
Yep. Oh, sure. He's not going to leave you cold. You know that. I mean, he's a genius and he has a reason for doing everything. And it's amazing. It's amazing to know where it's going. And when you see it, you're going to say, okay.
So you haven't started the next half yet. Have you? Haven't started filming that?
No, no. That starts in July. We're going to do 8 more. That'll come out in January.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And how's the, is the schedule when you guys are filming? Obviously, it's predicated on how many scenes you're in. But in general, because the cast is so large, is it a nice schedule? Is it a relaxing schedule for you?
Well, sometimes, like, that wedding stuff was, like, brutal. We were in Long Island for 2 weeks.
Right.
We had to do the church. We were in Brooklyn in the church.
Right.
And then we had to be in Long Island for the wedding. That was forever. I must have worked 10, 11 days on that show.
Right.
But some days you work 2 days. Some shows you work 2 days. Some shows you work 4. So it's all according with what's going on with the character. But the schedules are all great. They're about 15, 16 days of shooting.
We want to thank you for being part of the show, Frank.
I loved your Friday night, by the way, Adam.
Oh, thank you, Frank. Appreciate you watching over Jimmy Kimmel. Here's the deal. The Guy's Guide to Being a Man's Man, available now. It's a book by Frank Vincent. You know Miss Phil Leotardo. And also the Go Get Your Shine Box mugs, T-shirts, hats, diapers. He has them all.
Go home and get your f***ing shine box.
No better drop in radio. All right, now it is time.
Sounds like he's going to kill Gay Vito, by the way.
It does sound like he's going to kill Gay Vito. It is time for Maverick. Yes, Maverick?
What's up, bro?
The frat guy, 50-year teak from USC. He's doing the news.
Okay, cue the music.
It's playing.
It's going. It's time to go.
Organizers predict unprecedented participation in tonight's rallies against illegal immigration.
Mm-hmm.
The day
is
being called a day without immigrants.
Uh-huh.
Deaf Oscar...
Whoa. Yeah, here, we're going to take a swig of coffee. Let me just make
I need some water or something.
Let me make a little commentary, if you don't mind, Deaf Rat Guy. I think about it every once in a while. Like, our whole thing is like, we got to stiffen up the borders. We can't have these people coming over here and taking over. And then think about the names. Just think about the names of the cities here in the Southland. You have, as soon as you cross from Tijuana, you know what you cross into? Chula Vista. And then you go into San Diego, and then you go find Sepulveda, and that goes to Pasadena and San Bernardino and San Francisco and Santa Cruz and San Clemente. It just gets Los Angeles. It just keeps going and going and going. Perhaps we shouldn't name every goddamn thing in the Southland after a Spanish surname. Maybe that's a plan. Can you imagine... Imagine every street, every city, and every other mountain is named Chula something or Santa something, and our messages don't come here. It's a weird mixed message.
Yeah, but Mexico
doesn't have a Beaver Falls. El Segundo. If it had a Beaver Falls was in Tijuana, you'd want to go over there, or at least feel like that was your place. Yeah, be a little more enticing. Right. Mm-hmm. If you go look at a map of Los Angeles, or just go from San Francisco to San Diego and look at the names of the cities between San Francisco and San Diego. See if you can find any that don't start with a Santa or a Chula. Sorry, go ahead, Def Recca.
Speaking of Beaver, Oscar-winning actress Marley Matlin is joining the cast of Showtime's The L Word.
Uh-huh, the L Word.
Marley Matlin, is that your... She's, sort of the apple of your eye, I imagine.
Should play an artist who catches the eye of the Jennifer Beals character.
Uh-huh.
Hard to interact with.
Yeah, that's all right. You have to really focus on him. So she's joining the cast of the L Word.
Hell yeah.
Now, Deaf Rat Guy, you're a fan of hers because she's a deaf person who succeeded in Hollywood?
A lot of guys don't know this, but deaf chicks are crazy in this deck.
Oh, really? They put out. They overcompensate.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. See, Bruskett's not just midgets. It's also deaf chicks. All right, Deaf Rat Guy, sorry.
Charlie Sheen had his Denise tattoo removed from his left wrist.
Mm-hmm.
The British tabloids... say Tom Cruise and Katie Holmes are getting married on July 1st.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's your theme. Powering to the danger zone. Q
Keith Richards was hospitalized for a mild concussion last week after he fell out of a palm tree while vacationing in the Fiji Islands. Let's roll the audio clip. Okay, roll it.
It's rolling.
I mean, you don't try this at home, you know?
What the hell was he doing? He fell out of a coconut tree? Fell out of a palm tree?
While vacationing in Fiji, fell out of a palm tree.
I wonder, Johnny Depp basically fashioned his character in Pirates of the Caribbean after Keith Richards, and he sort of looks like him, and he sort of sounds like him. I wonder if Keith Richards, who's really, when he gets really high and sees that movie, if he thinks it's him, and he doesn't remember doing that film. So you got to figure, if you're really high on heroin or God knows whatever, you don't remember half the concerts you did. You don't remember half the stuff you did. You know, maybe he thinks he's in that movie. Look into that, Def Rat guy.
Mexico.
Thank you. Yeah.
So I just want to say something.
Mm-hmm.
Keith Richards is a really cool guy. But Mick Jagger gives me the creeps.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because of the whole thing with Moose.
What happened? Moose get some wood around him or something?
At the Super Bowl, we were watching the Stones do the national anthem, and I looked down and Moose had wood.
What?
And now, I don't want to say this on the radio.
Right.
But this weekend, Moose and Mike F were wrestling.
Yeah, it happened.
And Moose got it chubby.
Oh, no.
Oh, that is weird.
But
yeah.
Now it got really ugly.
Mm-hmm.
Poochie called Moose a fenoik.
Watching The Sopranos. Yeah. Yeah, I you know what? I just think you should stop looking down around Moose because it's just not going to help you at all. You know what I mean?
He's saying he's only semi-erect.
That's right. He's ready. It's like a volunteer fireman.
Introduce him to Gay Vita.
Mm-hmm.
Mexico is about to make a groundbreaking change to their drug law. Last Friday, lawmakers approved a bill that would make it legal for people to possess small amounts of reefer, heroin, opium, cocaine, LSD, ecstasy, and meth.
Mm-hmm.
You could carry 5 grams of reefer or about 4 joints.
Mm-hmm.
2 doses of H.
Mm-hmm.
5 grams of opium. 4 lines of blow.
Mm-hmm.
1 hit of acid.
Mm-hmm.
1 E-tab.
Uh-huh.
Or 4 hits of meth.
You know, we got to get off the metric system with the drugs because it's always confusing. Like, well, listen, it's considered a misdemeanor if you're caught with less than 500 milligrams of methamphetamine, but if you're over 0.2 metrograms of, is that a barrel load? Is that a truck load? Is that a pinch full? I never know what the amount is. Let's just go with joints or find some sort of, you know how you use fruit? You know, you go, it's about the size of an apple, about the size of a walnut or something like that. We need to figure out something with drugs. I have no idea how much or how little drugs I can carry into Mexico based on these new laws. I heard the whole breakdown, quarter ounce, 500 grams, 500 milligrams, all this stuff. I have no idea what that translates into.
I know that 1 joint is like 6 bong toke loads.
Okay, I'll write that down.
They were doing marijuana and heroin.
Are you good, Def Rat Guy?
That is the news. I'm Def Rat Guy. If you're not wasted, today in.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
We are living in very heady days if you're a pro basketball fan in L.A. Not so good if you're from Phoenix. Lakers won a classic at the Staples Center yesterday. Did you see it?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Suns up one in the closing seconds of regulation. They inbound the ball to the guy who apparently is going to be the MVP for the second straight season, Steve Nash, the great point guard. And then this happens.
They'd love to get it into Nash's hands, and they do.
They do.
Ball knocked away, stolen by Parker.
Oh, here it is.
Here comes George to Kobe Bryant. Bryant inside. It's good. It's good. Tie game.
Very exciting.
Did Bryant score that? Goal,
yeah, fantastic.
Score
floater.
That bucket.
Yeah, what a,
magnificent right.
bucket. And by the way, I was watching it in the mall. I was in the mall. Miss Cindy, my lovely bride, you know, I had some errands to run. I said I would go with her.
I was
TiVoing the Lakers game.
All right.
Hey, listen, I didn't think I would see anything of it. I was in the mall, for God's sakes. I wouldn't see what happened. Anyway, I hear these cheers as I'm walking down the hall. There are about 150 people gathered around a TV screen. All colors, all races, all creeds gathered around to watch the purple and gold. It was very exciting. It doesn't solve anything. All the people, all the Latinos, Asians, Jews, blacks, whites, everybody, all cheering an adulterous multimillionaire named Kobe Bryant. It was very exciting.
Yes, you guys put aside your racial differences for a minute to realize you're all men, you're all pee-whipped, and you're all at the mall.
That's right. Now listen.
That's the one thing you could agree on.
So that forces overtime. Then down one in the closing seconds of the overtime, this.
A one-point game. Walton can tip it. Bryant with the save.
Oh, you got to get a shot here.
Final seconds. Bryant for the win.
Bang! Pandemonium. It was really awesome. It was a fantastic game. So now the Lakers are up 3-1 in their series against the Suns. Mm-hmm. Meantime, the Clippers on Saturday night, they beat Memphis. They, too, are up 3-1, which means we are one win in both series away from the battle for L.A., Lakers, Clippers. That's going to be awesome if that goes down.
Yeah.
Let's root for that. Billy Crystal referred to it as the hallway series, which I like a lot since they play in the same
arena.
Building. That'll be really cool if that works out. Meantime, NFL draft Saturday and yesterday didn't go all that well for USC's big name guys. Reggie Bush, who clearly should have been the number one overall pick. Yeah, once in a generation kind of player.
Yes, he runs like a puma.
Yes.
He runs like he has four legs. You know, there's a weird thing when you watch him run. Other guys just sort of, you see him running and they run like human beings. He runs like he's clawing up at the turf. He just runs. You know when you see a cat run and it just, you can see they're being pushed by their hind legs but pulled by the front. That's kind of how he runs.
That's interesting. Yeah, he sort of has better traction than everyone else. He can put on the brakes and change directions better than anyone
else. Yes, it's weird. You know, people always talk about not the size you want in a running back. How many great running backs have been over 6 foot anyway?
Listen, with the returning of the punts and his ability to catch passes, like I say, once in a generation. But he got passed over by the Houston Texans for NC State defensive end Mario Williams. History will not remember this choice kindly. Mm. Mark my words. A defensive end over Reggie Bush. Retarded. Ace, here, let's prove it this way. You know who Sam Bowie is?
Yeah, but yes. The basketball player?
Yes. You know who he is?
Yeah, center.
Yes, but he was drafted by Portland
in before
1984
Michael Jordan.
By Michael Jordan. This will go down in the record, in the annals.
The way you asked me, do I know who Sam Bowie is, I couldn't tell if you wanted me to say no or
I
yes.
I didn't know if you knew that he was the guy that Michael Jordan got passed over for, and Portland has lamented this for
I focus mostly on adjustable wrenches, but I do know more sports than I'm giving credit for.
But then it wasn't just Reggie Bush at USC who had the tough day. Matt Leinart fell to 10th. Last year, he would have been the number one. He went to Arizona, which is cool for the Cardinals, and they should be a pretty good team in time with all those good receivers. But he would have been number one overall last season overall if he would have gone pro. So I feel bad for him. Then again, selfishly, I feel glad that he did come back so that we got to see that USC-Notre Dame game, the best college football game of all time.
Right.
And then Lendell White, poor fat Lendell White. Mm. He should have been a top 10 pick. He goes all the way to the second round. And I want to make one entry for definitely not a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
The Steelers traded up to get Santonio Holmes. Name is Santonio. He is 22 years of age, and he has three children.
definitely not a Jew. And he went in the second round of the NFL draft.
First round. Yes. Now, under the national pastime, painful game for the Dodgers yesterday down in Petco. Padres score 5 in the ninth, then win it in extra 6-5.
Oh, good Lord.
I'm going to get to something in a second. Halos got swept by the White Sox. Arizona dumped by the Giants. M's beat the O's. A's beat the R's of KCMO. Hate to say you're right, though, but I do want to go, now that we're through 1 month of baseball, let's take a quick look at the standings. LA's two baseball teams. The Dodgers and the Angels, 12 up, 13 down.
Oh, it's over. The season's over. They're 500.
Oakland A's, 12 and 12. Mariners.
Controversial.
Mariners swooning, 11 and 15.
All I'm saying is
Arizona also 12 and 13.
The Dodgers are both one game. The Dodgers and the Angels are both one game under 500.
That's right.
All right. And then so by the end of today, they'll be at 500.
Yeah.
And then tomorrow they'll go one game down.
That's right.
And then on Wednesday they go up to 500 again. This is why we don't need 162 goddamn games.
This is why we do, so that you get some difference between
everyone's 500. Who cares? Start it from the All-Star break. I don't know how you're going to decide who gets in the All-Star game. That'll be the tough part, but other than that we're fine. Yes, Steph Frat guy.
To all the people who didn't draft SC players, you will get what you deserve.
Oh, no, a vendetta.
Maverick. A pox you put on the team.
By the way,
I'm at Teak first, but I also go to SC. And I was really PO'd.
I see. Here's what I'm saying. Here's what I don't want you to do. And please listen to me on this. I don't want you to go back. I know the whole SC campus is a little bummed out by everyone being taken lower in the draft than you thought. And then the loss to Texas and the Rose Bowl. Do not go home, tilt a few, and think it's a good idea to take the safety off the potato gun and head out for retribution.
You're absolutely right. I will not use potatoes. Instead, I will use those mini pumpkins.
No. Don't put the mini gourds in there.
And I swear to God, I'm going to sharpen these stems.
Okay, listen.
It means business.
Please, Bruska, talk that frat guy down. I don't need him going out and seeking vengeance with his potato gun.
If the owner of the Houston Texans is listening, you better have eyes in the back of your head because there's a pumpkin with your name on it.
He hasn't talked like this since the ATO skirmish of '03.
Yeah, I gotta say this. Yeah, this is the potato gun basically has the equivalent of rock salt. That's just like mashed potatoes or something like that, or right up potatoes. But when you're getting out the miniature gourds and sharpening that stem, that's a cop killer. That's a hollow point, essentially.
The mini blue potatoes are good for like clearing out a party if some dudes come up and won't leave.
Right. That's a more scatter shot.
But if you disrespect Matt Leinart, who is a really cool dude.
Have you ever met him?
Well, Pucci is in a card game with him.
Okay, says he's cool. All right.
Pucci.
Dave Tamashek's number one sports.
We got to take a break. I was thinking about the gourds. Is there any more range than in the gourd department? You have the mini pumpkin. You have this, the mini one that's the size of a tangerine. And then you have the ones that you see on the news around Halloween that get up to 1,350 pounds that are sitting in the back of a pickup truck. What has more range than that? You think human beings? Human beings, like, well, they're little guys, and then there's Shaquille O'Neal. Yeah, he's twice his size. He's not 700 times his size.
Oh, I'll tell you one, as a matter of fact. How about that? You want to talk about human beings? Wangs. Same organ. Same organ.
Yes.
Something a lot different.
Yeah, two times as big, three times as big. Not the difference.
I guess that's true.
I say gourds. Take a break. Yes, Steph Rat guy.
So, it's interesting that Sully has been experimenting with nuts and frozen berries.
Oh, I see, in his potato gun. He really should get the Nobel Prize for that. We will take ourselves a quick break. Paul Rodriguez is coming in here. We'll talk to him about this whole day without immigrants after this.
The Adam Carolla Show.
Chicanos, we're more practical with it, right? You ask a Mexican that has won the lottery gold, what am I going to do with the money?
Well, first of all, I think I'm gonna tune the car. Then I guess I'll go to Magic Mountain.
Paul Rodriguez is in studio. We would have had Paul in anyway, but we thought might as well have him in during the
year.
You're
just trying to get me in trouble because I'm a scab to my people now. You know, yeah. I'm actually working.
They don't consider this work, by the way. You're not sweaty or anything. Here's the thing. We work over on Wilshire Boulevard, and the march is going straight down in front of our place of work. So this place is going to be shut down. There was a memo in the office going around saying, we're leaving at noon. Everyone's going home at noon, which initially got me excited, and then I realized that's when I go home, and then I was angry.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, you know, I'm empowered by the committee to give you mm-hmm. a special dispensation. You
oh,
know?
Really?
Yeah, you know, we're
going to stamp my card for
yeah,
me.
Yeah, it's like it's unreal the things that are happening. For example, Cesar Chavez Boulevard is on strike.
The actual street.
Yeah, the actual street is on strike. All lights are off.
They should screw it.
Yeah. And,
or maybe they should all turn brown in solidarity.
People aren't looking at the upside of this strike. For example, there will be no drive-bys.
Oh, yeah, it's interesting.
No drive-bys. But, all violence will have to be on foot.
No tagging, no nothing.
No tagging, no, you know. It's a lot of, I like to look at the silver lining of this thing. You know, we're focusing too much on the negativity and the separation. There's going to be a lot of good things, you know.
Well, what is your story? What is your family story? Where do you come from? What part of Mexico? When did you come here?
I come from Los Angeles. That's a part of Mexico.
It is now, yeah.
You know, slowly. No, my grandfather on my mother's side was mm-hmm. An immigrant, a German immigrant who settled in New Braunfels, Texas.
Wow.
And he was persecuted because he was Mormon. And he went down to Chihuahua where he met grandma, and then they took off to Culiacan. Mm-hmm. And my father is Native American. He's a Tarahumara, as he likes to call it, the non-casino-owning Indians.
Yeah.
It sucked my whole life.
You just left with alcoholism and diabetes
exactly.
If you don't own a casino.
A lot of maize.
It's got to be nice, though. It's got to be a nice moral victory if you're American Indian. You go like, well, you don't have anything, but you see that mountain? That's named after you, and that SUV,
your grandpa.
That baseball team.
Exactly.
It's all named after you. By the way, you can't drive the car going to the stadium, but it's all named after you.
He's never been to Cleveland. Well, actually, the Tarahumara Indians were in the side of Chihuahua when the land was partitioned. They were obviously on the wrong side. But what I'm trying to tell you is that what a lot of people don't understand, and of course, I'm American. I mean, I was mm-hmm. on the Air Force. I see myself mm-hmm. American, but a lot of people don't realize that, you know, this land wasn't empty. Mm-hmm. You know? So when this thing happened, it's kind of like not as populous as Germany, though. There's people who have families on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really cut and dry.
They go way back.
It's not. Now, I'm not saying this applies to everybody, and mm-hmm. of course, you know, this coalition, this thing that we're doing at the Laugh Factory, this press conference thing like that, is just an attempt for us to show a little levity.
Mm-hmm.
And because I'm really scared of this thing. I think it inflames passions on both sides.
Uh-huh.
I don't think, like burning the Mexican flag, it's only going to upset some moron on that side who's going to do something to these morons that we have native born here.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the vast majority of people basically want a logical solution. America is a place of solutions.
Yeah.
We can find that. All I'm doing with me and my fellow comedians is offering a solution, if comical. We formed a group called Comic.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's unclear to a lot of people exactly what immigrants, Mexicans, illegal immigrants, whatever we're calling them, what they want out of today, what they want to get out of today, what the goal would be.
Well, it's unclear to me either. I think bus passes. You know, I think they're fighting for bus passes, I don't know.
Bob is here to fan some flames. Bob?
Bob, fan the flames, you know?
Go ahead, Bob.
What's up, Paul? How you doing?
What's
How happening? You doing, Adam?
Good.
Hey, Paul, what's your first name, your real name?
Paul?
Come on.
What do you mean? Pablo?
Moisha.
Pablo?
There you go, Pablo.
Call me Pablo. Hey.
Well, I have a problem with, the way the media presents this is immigrants are, they're all getting
together, but the fact is they're illegal immigrants. I've got friends that are immigrants that had took the long way, the long road to get there, and, you know, and now everything on the news is about the immigrants. Well, my Burger King is going to be shut down for the day. Big deal.
All right.
Well, listen, I don't think you've been listening to me. I think we're on the same side here, dude. You just assume, see, you just assume that because my name is Rodriguez and you call me Pablo, that I'm for illegal aliens coming in here, see? Wrong, dude.
I'm not defending that.
I don't understand what part of illegal they don't understand. I understand it. It's illegal. Got it, man. I'm not saying come in here. What I'm saying is that there shouldn't be violence. And
right.
So far there hasn't
been much.
Well, let's keep it like that. You know?
Yeah, I agree.
That's what I said. All we're doing, you know, this group is, by the way, fictitious group, is basically Jamie Masada, and we do have some
over at the Laugh Factory.
At the Laugh Factory, we're going to have, you know, some, we want to take a bite of basically... There has to be a lighter side to this,
yeah,
you know.
Agree.
And that's all I'm doing. Do not misunderstand me. For those of you who are already in line, lighting up the boards to call them, just because
Bob, we have Jay and Bob on the phone. Jay's from Sacramento, and Bob is from San Francisco. This is my point. We shouldn't name everything.
Yeah. Now dig this. Now.
Yeah.
You know, to me, it's humorous, man. You're a comic. You see it this way. They want to build a wall. I'm saying, well, who's going to build it?
Well, let me... You know, that's a good point.
The last white guy in construction I saw was in the Village People.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, if you're going to... You know, we're looking at the situation from a comedic point of view, strictly comedic. You needn't take me serious.
Let me come at it from a less comedic point and say, to me, it's a really... It always is about rich and poor in this country.
Absolutely, in the whole world.
In the whole world.
Right.
And people talk about, well, you discriminate against these people, but it's really that the lion's share of the Mexican immigrants are poor, and thus poor people get their ass kicked.
Absolutely.
Rich people don't get their ass kicked, and that's basically what it boils down to.
You know, it's like this guy, what was it, this guy that just called me? You know, I don't know what his point was. You can call me, you know, Bob Dylan said, you can call yourself whatever you want to call me. I could have turned around and go, no, your real name, your ancestral name, it's Seamus, by God, it's Seamus. You know, well, I hold no problem, unless you're a Native American, right? But
well,
spare me, you know, it's like I have...
What do you think of this, though? I was walking my dog yesterday, and I started thinking about it. And I thought, I don't even know where I come down on half this stuff, but I don't like the liberals' take on, I don't like people throwing around the racist tag as easily as we've done over the last few years. It seems very easy for everyone just to wag their finger and call everyone else racist. And I thought, obviously, the bleeding heart left-wing liberals are very down with the brown-skinned man and in the plight of anybody who comes into this country.
I've heard so much racist crap is what I'm saying.
But where would these people be? And just think about it for a second. Everyone, close your eyes. Use your imagination. Think about all the super left-wing Hollywood types. Think about the Tim Robbins types, Alec Baldwin, whoever else, Bill Maher, whoever you think of, super left-wing. Oswaldo's from Nicaragua. What if I said, I'm going to take me and a bunch of other my white friends, and we're all going to relocate to Nicaragua. But here's what we want. We want to celebrate the 4th of July.
Wouldn't happen.
We want English taught in the schools as well. We don't want just Spanish. We don't want our kids speaking with Nicaraguan accent. We want English taught. We want the phone book to come out in our language. We want to celebrate. We want to hang the American flag. We want to take the Nicaraguan national anthem, and we want to convert it to English. Well, these people would be outraged by that.
Well,
they would be the first people screaming, you're crushing their culture. You can't do this. How dare you? How dare you take your culture and foist it upon them? It's interesting, I think, that the same people that are complaining about the way we feel about our culture being usurped by another culture would be the first to mouth off if we went to another culture and forced it on. They're the first people that complain about Disneyland going to France.
Yeah.
All right. Heavy. Not funny, but think about it. Swap the circumstances.
All right, let me try to lighten that up. You know,
please.
Adam, what you're saying here,
yeah.
And I'm with you, baby. Now, what you say? Look, you hit it right on the first place. The problem is, I've traveled the world. I was in the service. I was in Military Airlift Command, the American Air Force, by the way, who were my callers.
Mm-hmm.
The world, everywhere. Look, I go to Japan, and in Japan is a predominantly Japanese society. they have a few Koreans because those are their Mexicans.
Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
know, in Mexico, they have Guatemalans. Those are their Mexicans.
Right.
It's a very famous movie, Water, Bread and Chocolate. Mm-hmm. It's in Switzerland, they got Italians. Those are their Mexicans.
Right.
Now, all I'm saying is that every culture, every society, you know, Germany has Turks.
Right.
Those are their Mexicans. What I'm saying is, I'm not disparaging or being ashamed. I'm proud to be a Mexican. I was the first one on you know, there's other Mexican comics now, but I was the first one. I'm proud of that. I've never been ashamed. I didn't change my name or nothing, so don't get me wrong.
Sure, Pablo.
I'm an American. I got it the other way. I'm an American a Mexican.
Right.
You know, which is the way it should be. But what I'm trying to say, it's a question of poverty. Look, just put yourself on the other side of the shoe. I'm defending. I'm just putting it out there. All right. You know, if these people would not be here, right? Mm-hmm. They would not be here if neither the Democratic or the Republican Party is all that opposed to having this door shut. Look, I own some farms,
mm-hmm. You do.
Some orchards up north, Northern California.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen a white migrant farm worker.
Right.
I've never seen a black migrant farm worker.
No.
I've never seen a Filipino. Yes, I have. I see one or two, sure. But they own the damn farms. Seriously. I've never seen...
They're Mexicans with weird eyes, but they weren't actually Filipino.
They're just shorter Mexicans, you know?
Right. No, I work construction. I never worked. I work construction my entire life here in Los Angeles. I never worked with any Asians or any blacks.
A
handful of whites, almost all Mexicans.
Adam, what I'm saying is we can't have it, our cake and eat it. Look, the situation is either we establish some kind of system that they actually had in the 40s when most of the young Americans were fighting World War II. They had a bracero program, which mm-hmm. is a guest worker thing. You have more control about it, or you shut down that border, or you don't. But look, it is also a racist thing. Yes, the vast majority, because of the proximity of Mexico, mm-hmm. are Mexicans. But Canadian border, you know, hey,
well,
there's a lot of Canadians here, except they happen to be majority white. They blend in. If I walk down the street with Jim Carrey, mm-hmm. you would think that he's far more American than I am.
Do you know him, and can you get him on the show?
Yeah, I do. I do know Jim. And
we're going to tackle the tough Canadian issues now with Jim Carrey.
Look, if Jim Carrey and me and, let's say, Michael Fox are walking down the street, who do you suppose is more American?
Wow.
You would say both of them, right?
Right.
Wrong.
You.
Me.
That's right.
I mean,
they're crazy Canucks.
But see, what you can't, what the peg is, what I'm afraid of this, look, in the ultra right of both sides, mm-hmm. what scares me is the hardcore Mexicano, gang member, quasi mafia, whatever it is.
You're talking about Villaraigosa.
No. and the far right, these Minutemen, these,
right.
which I don't know what kind of man wants to be call himself that, but that's his thing.
Yeah.
These Minutemen.
See, I know. I'm
on both these sides, these people have myopic views on this issue. The issue is a lot bigger than just one way.
I completely agree. We need to take a break.
Yeah.
Paul Rodriguez is here. I have many more thoughts on this as
and
well.
And listen, folks, Paul. I will lighten them up as Adam.
Go ahead, but I got a heavy one. I got a heavy one coming up.
Is it in your pants?
We will. No, I got the Minuteman in my pants. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with Paul Rodriguez after this. Well, I hear you. Mm-hmm. The immigrant song. Yeah.
Appropriate.
One Led Zeppelin song I know the name of. Actually, Stairway to Heaven is about the only one they ever did that has the words in the actual song.
I've heard the song in Spanish.
The immigrant song?
Yeah, Stairway to Compton. It's a different beat. It's got more congas. But I actually like it, you know?
Paul Rodriguez is in studio. We're talking about the Great American Boycott. Day without immigrants. We have to shut down early here at the office at noon. But
see, there's an upside, eh?
Yeah, except for I leave at noon. And the only thing worse than me not getting to leave early from work is hearing that others get to leave early.
Well, should you be confronted? Look, it's like when I traveled to Europe, when I was in France, mm-hmm. you know, and I realized that they hate Americans, I became Canadian.
Smart.
When I was older, they like Canadians, you know, that's
mm-hmm.
cool.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would say it's like when you walk down the street, should there be any rough spot, just tell them you're Argentinian.
All right.
Those are white Latinos. Yeah.
Where's my gauchos when I need them?
You're gaucho, you eat at the grill, you know, you like bolo. And, you know.
Paul Rodriguez in here because, well, Oswaldo was in earlier, but he's in every Monday.
You know, Oswaldo and I hooked up, man. I'm a big fan of Oswaldo and I. We were out there talking, man.
Oh, really?
That's from Nicaragua.
How's his Spanish? Is that...
Well, it's terrible. It's what it is. It's terrible.
Because his English is worse.
You know, he's always telling me, man, I am not learning English.
No,
and I'm
kidding.
Forgetting my Spanish.
Yeah.
So he's basically getting a language all to his own.
Ozzy, is there a third language you speak? Please.
Yes.
He can't pronounce my name.
You know, Osvaldo and I are gonna buy a summer home in Mexico now that all the drugs are legal. And basically, we want to sublease it to Rush Limbaugh. That's our respect. Vamos a ir allá con Rush Limbaugh. Vamos a hacer mucho marijuana, ¿sí?
Oh, the yoing?
Yeah, see, the yoing.
Why don't you guys talk some smack about me in Spanish? That'd just be fun.
Que este güero te está dando aquí trabajo.
Me da trabajo y me da carrilla.
See, he's talking good about you. He says you gave him work, man. He loves you. But I just, personally, don't call him master. I don't like that.
I insist,
that's
though.
That's just wrong.
Well, how about your highness?
Maestro.
Well, usually, he doesn't. I'm not doing
maestro,
it either.
Maestro.
He calls me, I insist on being called maestro or jefe.
Check this out. Off the air, I'm talking to this guy, right?
Mm-hmm.
This guy was tortured by the Somoza government, man. This guy has, you know, it touched my heart. For a guy that's gone through stuff like that to have a sense of humor. What I'm saying is this group that we're having a conference at the Laugh Factory, we have some preambles. We have some things. Oswaldo's one of them. Our thing is...
Oswaldo's here on political asylum.
Yeah, we're for immigration. If they look like Selma Hayek, we think that anyone that looks like her should be immediately sent over to Osvaldo's or my house.
Bring us your you know, huddled masses in your decocks.
For a year, Osvaldo and I, we run a halfway house for girls that don't go all the way. But we think that in a year, we can do that, huh?
Yep.
See? You'd be a great straight man, yo.
Osvaldo, tell Paul, I want you to explain to him in your native tongue, in Spanish, to explain how I was keeping it real all those years, swinging a hammer, working side by side with the brown man.
Oh, that's
your
construction,
bread.
Right?
Yep. Yeah.
¿Tú lo conoces desde ese tiempo?
Yeah, tengo como 16 años de conocerlo.
Oh, dude, you know.
Almost 16 years, you know, I know Adam Carolla.
Yeah?
Thank you.
Hey, was he a good worker? ¿Sabía qué hacía él?
He's a good carpenter, man. He's a Finnish carpenter.
You know, see? Mm-hmm. No wonder he likes you, because, you know, Jesus was a carpenter.
Yeah.
And
he called me, you know...
I didn't gouge the elderly, though. That's the difference between me and Jesus.
sometimes, you know, this day, call me Chiso.
See?
Yeah, it's a disgusting name. We'll get into it later. Wyona?
Yes?
Hold on a second. Yes, Ozzy, you want to finish something?
I suppose, you know, he called me Chiso. He says Chiso, you know, the formon.
Uh-huh.
But somebody tell to me the Chiso is the, you know, the...
Yeah.
I said, oh, my God.
I have no idea what he said, and I know pretty good Spanish.
I'll explain it to you off the air.
Chisel.
It's filthy. It's filthy. All right, let's see. Construction worker in Las Vegas, not working today. Nick?
Yeah, that's what's going on.
Nick, you're working construction in Las Vegas?
Yeah, I work construction in Vegas, and our shop's closed down today. Our company's closed because of all this crap. And what I don't understand is why I get to lose out on a day's pay because people don't feel like going to work.
Well, that's the interesting thing.
That's the crux of the matter, isn't
it? Yes.
The matter is that if you look at talk radio, you look at the ultra-rights, they want to kick every... if they kicked all 12 million, guesstimated, Mexicans out of here, you'd have an underemployed problem, you know?
Well, let me say a couple things on that. First off, again, I really do think what we call racism oftentimes breaks down in socioeconomic lines. Cops pull over black people more than they pull over white people, no doubt about it. But the people they pull over, number one, poor people. They pull up beat up cars that have expired tags.
Don't go as fast.
That have four or five people in it that don't go as fast.
Right.
That have a couple bald tires and a little primer on it. And they think, dude, there may be trouble.
Hey, he's describing your car, Osvaldo. That's just wrong. You gotta pay this man right.
That was his car before the Ford F-250 I co-signed for over at Galpin Ford. Please tell him that I co-signed for your last two vehicles.
And what has your sister have to do for him?
Oral.
Robert.
You know, it's practical, you know. Anytime somebody helps you, you know.
Yeah.
And you say, you know, muy agradecido.
Sí, very, very grateful.
Very grateful, you know.
Mm-hmm. All right, Oz, that's enough ass kissing. Yep. I'm sorry. Sorry I brought it up.
You know, there's a sweetness to you, my man. There's a niceness to you, you know? I feel like you're not putting no airs here.
Yes.
I'm trying to be funny. You You shouldn't even be in this messy, ugly Hollywood business. Wait for me in the locker room.
That's right.
Anyways,
let me. Let me give you my opinion. First off, I think poor people are the people that get discriminated the most against in this society. And the thing about the Latin culture is, we talked about this a few weeks back, that this was a melting pot, now it's turned into a crock pot. And I know it sounds ridiculous, but what I mean is in the melting pot, everything just melts, and it all turns into one sort of brownish, grayish color. In the crock pot, you got the potatoes over here, you got the beef over here, and you got the carrots over here. I think that's what we're doing as a nation. We got the blacks over here, we got the whites over here, we got the Mexicans over there, and we got the Chinese over there. I don't think that's a great plan. I'm not sure that we can support that weight of sort of everyone breaking off into their own group. And furthermore, I don't think it's a good idea for the immigrants to do it. Because what are you escaping? What are you leaving? And why create a facsimile of that? Isn't that just the same thing? If you're living in Mexico, and then you essentially move across the border 110 miles and then create another Mexico with the language, with the flags, with the jobs, with the poverty, with the same situation that you had when you were there, then Why leave in the first place?
Well, look, you were talking earlier about, you know, you wouldn't like it if we went over there. They did that. You know, after the Civil War, the San Patricios, which is the Confederates, they went to Chihuahua, they went to Mexico, and they created their to this day, you go to areas, and they have imposed their white rules and white whatever it is. Of course, they're too small to make a difference, whereas the people that are coming over here for economic reasons are vast. We're the vast majority of us were Catholic. We have large families and all that. And I'm not apologizing for that at all. The situation is that these rules are not a race thing. They are an economic thing.
Yeah.
And as the thing goes on, look, our beautiful young ladies are marrying white boys because they want to be homeowners. And I'm not saying that all of them, but
and we need the home cleaned.
Right, there you go. and you want to, you know, they have traditional values, which you find appealing. What happened with that? It happened in Europe. It happened with the Filipino girls. It happened in every war. Now, see, the only reason that you say that is the proximity. You know, from Tijuana all the way down to Punta del Fuego, every nation speaks Spanish, with the exception of Belize and French Guiana and Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
But you're talking about over a billion people speaking Spanish. Now, if this border was up against, let's say, England or another English-speaking country, then it'd be another form of racism. It'd be like, you know, Northern Irish and
right.
Southern Irish, whatever it is. But because of the proximity, yes, the vast majority are Mexican Americans, and yes, they do have. But look, trip on this. Whoever's listening to this, I'm not defending. It's just historical facts. Los Angeles, it's not a Scandinavian name.
No.
It was named that for a reason. So the roots to the Spanish, to the Milicias, they go further back than you think. So it's kind of insulting to me to have a German ancestry and then hop on your high horse and go, and you can't even speak English without an accent, and you're governor, and then be anti-immigrant like that. I don't think America's an anti-immigrant. With this illegal immigration, I'm against illegal immigration.
You know, we're anti disassimilation, if that's a word.
Right.
We don't care where you're from. Start blending in. I think that's the problem.
Well, yeah, but see, look, I remember when I was, I'm 51 years old, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, and I remember when I was whacked in the hands for speaking Spanish. That's how they taught you English in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And then they reversed. They did a backward altogether, where now, even I'm against that, where they have bilingual education, which only confuses two kids. It's hard enough to learn something in one language. And then now they have called immersion programs. It's just a waste of time. I mean, the liberals keep throwing money and money at education. But the problem is complex.
Yeah. Sylvia?
Complex. Yes.
Sylvia's going to make it more complex. Sylvia, what do you think?
Well, you know what? I am voting for the law. I think that if you want to be in the United States, you have to earn the privilege of being in the United States.
I agree.
What's your nationality?
I am Hispanic.
Mm-hmm.
I was born and raised in Mazatlan.
Yes, Sinaloa.
Yeah, Sinaloa. Yes, I am 100% Mexicana, but I believe if I was doing it legally, I did it legally, I came into the United States, I paid the $5,000, $6,000 fine
Oh, I thought you guys a coyote.
Yes.
No, yeah. You know, Patricia,
I think everybody should do it correctly.
You know, there's a lot of us, Adam, like Patricia and myself, who here absolutely legal. We have legal. We have every right to be here. We defend this country. This is our country primarily. As a matter of fact, when I want to feel really as an American, I go to Mexico.
Yeah.
I'm over there currently filming a movie, right?
So no, Mo, I feel.
So
I mean,
but I'm saying a lot of people like Patricia and I, we silently believe this, but we don't really want to be too vocal because we'll catch a lot of hell saying that you've forgotten, you're not. You don't care about these people. Yes, there are brothers and sisters. Some are even related. But the fact is, I cannot get behind.
You don't want to be Uncle Tom Bien.
Right, yeah. Tom Bien. But I don't think that there's no way we could accept the law, breaking the law.
No, they've pulled the legal Mexicans that are at least in this city, and they found out that most of them want to uphold the law.
Well, the people that get hurt the most is look. Why should you hire? Right. Why should you hire? Let's say, why should you hire me or my buddy here?
Right.
For living wages, when you can hire two people just like us, probably don't speak English as well.
Right.
But not by too far. For let's say. Less than half the price. People that really get hurt are those of us who are working here legally.
Well, we got to take a break, but hang out because I want to get into that. Yeah, speaking of money, we got to pay the bills. But I do want to get into that because I think that's a little bit of a misnomer. I grew up poor. I worked as a laborer.
You've never been poor. You're a white man. We believe that the minute you're born, there's a 401k plan established for him. Isn't that what you told me?
Welfare and food stamps, brother.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. Damn. Not exactly.
You're a lucky person.
Ozzy, please tell him during the break how poor I was when we met.
Let's get break.
I don't know what that means. Paul Rodriguez is here. Ozzy's going to do a movie review. See if he can make $100. And we'll be back after this.
Ozzy said that he went to see A Day Without a Mexican.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Paul Rodriguez is in studio, as well as Oswaldo. Robert's on the phone. He liked my Uncle Tom Bien.
Adam, man, it just got blown over in the hot discussion, but major props on Uncle Tom Bien.
Very clever.
Thank you. We should adopt that. Now, somebody...
He's witty.
Well, I don't know. It's probably been said, although I haven't heard it. Has anyone heard Uncle Tom Bien?
I would tell you right now, because I'm on the cutting edge of these bilingual stuff. I'll tell you right now, you can have that, pretty much out of public domain stamped as yours.
So I get Uncle Tom Bien. When the dust settles and the book of Adam Carolla is written on my headstone, it will be the inventor of Uncle Tom Bien and the behymen, which is the male's rectum once you're a virgin. And then it gets broken when you're gay. You break the behymen.
Well, they actually have a book. You know, they have a book called the quotes from comedians. What is it called? My secretary's got that. And they actually, you can look your name up, and they have quotes there. Like for example, I think there's a guy there who used to write for the Tonight Show. What's his name? Jimmy Brogan, who has who's attributed to the word "Where are you from?"
Really?
He wrote that.
Wow.
He has that.
Well, all I want is Uncle Tom Bien, and I will sleep like a baby. Clem?
Yeah, this is Clem. I'm from South Carolina. I just pulled on over off the interstate using the payphone.
I see.
Hey, como estas, Pablo? Your name ain't Paul, it's Pablo. Why'd you change it to Paul, for one?
I like Paul better.
I'll tell you right now. Here's my problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if all the Mexicans ain't gonna go to work today, who's gonna ride? Who's gonna wash my truck? I can't get my truck all washed up.
How about you? Right. How about you?
Well, no, I'm gonna tell you right now. I was Waldo, made fun of that spartangled banner.
I don't understand. On what side of this issue are you? And are you for illegal aliens?
I think he's on the unfunny bad comedy side of this issue.
I think I'm gonna change my name to Ned.
I like Clem.
All right.
Adam, I'm changing my name to Clem. You know. Whenever you have people that want to talk about white supremacists, I'm starting to believe it because they they're very smart. They did it, and then you got a guy like Clem. Makes me believe
I think he was trying to do a character. I'm hoping he was trying to do a bad racist character.
Can we repeat this one more time, folks? My name is Paul Castro Rodriguez. Now, if you want me to be Pablo, Okay, I'm Pablo. Today I'll be Pablo. How's that?
Ozzy, how about you pronounce my name correctly?
Hey, Ozzy, how about you change your name to Clem? Dile que usted se llama Clem usted. Clem or Clem? Clem.
Ozzy's so bad with names, the two options he gives you aren't the one you gave him. Steve?
Yeah, how you doing?
What do you have to say?
Well, two things. Number one, Uncle Tom Bien is brilliant.
Thank you.
That is.
Spread it around.
You know, I'm Italian and Jew, so you know, that's a whole thing there.
Yeah.
Everybody here is so afraid of foreigners.
Hair, if I ever heard it. Yeah.
There's a joke right there.
Yeah. What? Foreigners, yes.
Everybody here is so afraid of foreigners, and it's ridiculous. I mean, you know, you go to Europe, everybody's a foreigner.
Yeah, I don't think, I want to say this in on behalf of all white folks. I'm an atheist and I'm poor, or was
You ain't poor.
Poor
no more, man. I see your face all over.
No, I'm not
you're right
poor
next
anymore.
To, you're on the buses. You're right next to that dude pointing the finger with the 2-2-2-2-2-2 number.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Yes. Have you been hitting your minivan?
But,
here's what I really do feel like this nation is not as nearly as racist as
no,
we think
isn't.
We are. We obsess over it. We talk about it. It somehow has become a hotbed issue, and it's come up more and more over the last 2 years than it ever should have. I mean, if people, there's a couple things. If you were marching, if you were doing civil rights marches in the 60s, there's two things you would have been very disappointed at. One, all the talk of racism that still goes on 30, 40 years later.
Right.
Two, pot still illegal. Those are the two things you would have assumed would have been done by the year 2000 quite easily.
Right.
We're obsessed with it. I do think people recognize the difference in other cultures. I think it's human nature to point out those differences. I think it's human nature to point out when a guy cuts you off in a car and he has a nationality. You bring it up.
Don't bring the Asian people here in the driving skills. Please, come on, Adam.
It's true. When the guy is fat, you bring it up. When it's a chick, you bring it up. Anything different than you.
Yeah, because it's safe. Look,
you bring it up. But I don't think there's a difference, I think, between thinking that and doing something about it.
Yeah.
And I know many people that have made many racial jokes, including myself, in their life.
Right.
But I don't know anyone that's actually done anything to hurt anyone that was different than they are just because they were different than they are. But
there's that Jerry Springer crowd, but, you know, there's a black man being dragged, you know, behind the car. There are idiots.
There are, but it's a very, very small
America,
minority.
America is the kind of
speaking of minorities.
America is the kind of country that it did something 20, 30 years later in Manzanar to the Japanese Americans and has paid them back. America is basically a great country. I've traveled the world.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think, you know, what the Mexican immigration does to Guatemalans when they cross over is horrendous.
Yes.
What they do to Salvadorians is horrendous.
You want to see racism, go travel the
world
and I'll show you real racism.
We were in Mozambique shooting, check this out, we were in Mozambique shooting Ali.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm in the bus, we're going to this where we're filming the final fight.
Mm-hmm.
Over there, you have many tribes. You have the Bantu, who basically are the untouchables.
Mm-hmm.
They collect the people that, you know, people down the street, and they just pick them up and throw them into the Zambezi River.
Right.
And then all the shop owners are Hindu.
Mm-hmm.
All the shop owners are Hindu. And there's a class distinction like you wouldn't believe. Now, that never comes up. You won't have Mr. Jackson talking about the dreadful and horrible governments in Africa that make the dreadful regimes in Latin America look like something
we gotta
to
envy. We've got to focus on Mark Furman using the N-word and decide that all white people are horrible.
Exactly. Now, I believe that in the heart of hearts, African Americans, they, you know, talk privately to them. They know that Simpson, you know, allegedly, I got to say that for lawsuit purposes, was guilty. I mean, you know, they do that. But I think they did that to vindicate for all that ripe fruit hanging in a poplar tree.
Mm-hmm. I think I know what that meant. Let me, we got to take a break. We're supposed to have Ozzy do a movie review. Oswaldo's going to do it when we come back. So
he's going to do it off the air.
Paul Rodriguez, you'll hang out with us?
I got nothing better to do, man. I'm unemployed.
We'll take a quick break. Promise a movie review from Oswaldo when we come back.
And now, Oswaldo reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. Number 8, from Star Wars.
May the forces be with you.
Now,
back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Stirring. Powerful. Paul Rodriguez in studio. Hey. We're talking about the great American.
Pablo Rodriguez. Clem outed me.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Like I said, I'm hoping he was a caricature and not a real human being. Oswaldo?
Hi.
What's happening, my brother?
I listened to the new name for Paul. Now it's Paolo.
Pablo.
Paolo,
yes.
Paolo, I'm Italian. Paolo.
And also, not only does Oswaldo kiss my ass, but he also does a little movie reviewing around here. What movie are you doing this morning?
Stick it.
Brought to you by DuPont.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
Here we go.
Okay.
Oswaldo, tell us about some movie.
Megas ripped off Chico and the Men.
They ripped us off. I like that.
Los Jose Feliciano know about this.
The movie
Hold on one second. I want to see if we can use you, Paul, to get through to Oswaldo on a couple things. First off, I'd like him to learn to pronounce my name because it's been 16 years and he still pronounces my name. Number one. Number two, explain to him when the husky lesbian with the huge areolas named Jimmy Brusca points at him, that means it's time for him to talk. Not time for him to begin thinking about talking someday. But actually talking when he gets the finger.
Listen, as his agent, I really feel offended.
Not representing him. Tell him when he gets the finger. Tell him in Spanish, mira, when the lesbian gives him the finger, he has to talk.
Cuando esta chica te punta así, tú tienes que empezar.
Pero es que sometimes, you know, it's pointing me, you know, in my face. I almost get out of my eyes.
Yeah, it's distracting.
Osvaldo says that he's big in Nicaragua.
All right, here we go.
Right, point
yeah, give him the finger.
The movie that I saw this weekend was Sticky. It's a star, Mrs. Perigamas.
So what happened? Somebody spilled a drink on the floor? It was a sticky?
Sticky.
Hey, is this one of them movies that Pee-wee Herman would see, isn't it?
Pee-wee?
Starring Pee-wee Herman.
Stick it, yes. Yeah, who does it star?
It star Mrs. Perigamas.
Right. What? Yeah. Looks like her name.
It's Holly.
Mm-hmm.
Vanessa Lenges is Joanne.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff Bridges is Burt Bickerman.
Who?
Burt Bickerman.
Burt Vickerman?
I don't know what your problem is, Adam, but I understand him clearly. he makes a lot of sense to me.
Let me ask you something, Paul. Maybe you can help clear this up, because I could never figure this out.
Okay.
I have a barber who's, I think he's Cuban or something, and he told me one day he was going to trade in his Bobo for a Sauv. Now, I said, you can say V and you can say B because you took Volvo and you turned it into Bobo, and you took Sauv and turned it into Sauv. Why can't you say it at the right time? You know what I'm saying?
When you're not around, we actually enunciate and talk very well.
Oh.
We just do that to irritate you.
Oswaldo, Burt Vickerman.
Vickerman.
No, not Bickerman. Vickerman.
Vickerman.
There you go. Vagina, not vagina.
Vagina.
Oh, that's weird. Don't ever do that again.
It's got saliva coming out.
Clitoris.
All right, buddy. It's getting weird now.
Clitoris.
All right. Come on, Ozzy.
He says Clinton. Something about Clinton and a girl named Iris.
Burt Vickerman. Yes.
Burt Vickerman. Nikki Soho.
Good.
Is Wei Wei.
Wei Wei.
And Mary Curley as Mina.
All right.
Sticky is a film.
Stick it is a film
about the rebel girl who did not complete the life to a different shape, the development and the general function from the complement, discipline, and character.
Hey, I already want to go see it already.
I don't know what that means, but I don't have time to untangle that mess.
For me, this movie is one classic BS.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You didn't like it, huh?
In one occasion, you saw in one Olympic ceremony, somebody make an option versus the youth to national level.
Yeah.
He says that it's a fictitious movie because a white guy becomes world champion in boxing.
It's a funny movie. It's not real.
Not real.
It's a parody version for the competition and the Olympic thing in the United States of America.
It's a parody, is what you're saying.
No, it's a Parati. That's, that's what we call it. Those are very expensive cars.
So it's an Italian beer.
I have a Parati.
My favorite part was the end when I left the theater.
Wow.
In the end, Sticky left the reviewer call.
you know, Osvaldo, your clarity, your insightfulness. I see Ebert calling. Seriously. I see Ebert calling, and it'll be like, you know, I mean, that's what you're what they need. You're the new face of America. Don't you forget it, buddy.
Allison?
Yes.
I remember.
What's happening?
Hello there. Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I was very interested in what you were saying, getting to the poverty issue and how that affects, I think, the status of people who are legal or illegal immigrants when they come in. And as an educator, so I teach first grade, and...
Do you have room for Osvaldo?
Yeah, teach him English, please.
We can work on that. But what I think, what happens so often is we interpret the sort of, you know, whether it's lack of academic success, which then leads to you know, not having a lot of choices in jobs and with their economic power, spending power, that kind of thing, that if we were doing a better job, I think, getting students, immigrant students, Latino students, fluent, illiterate in both English and Spanish, and that is such a hot-button issue, and I'm not a bilingual educator, actually have a lot of reservations about, you know, let's just teach them English, but over the course of my career, as I've read more and more research, it turns out, and it's no shock to anybody that's ever taught, you know, bilingual education, when you educate students in and get them literate in their first language at the same time as you're working on literacy in English, they outperform, you know, their peers who have only had English literacy.
Well, you know, I think the boring.
That's a great thing.
First language, that's where the problem lies
but the point is,
should be their first language.
We understand that, but the point is, we're talking about people that got here legal. The schools are being overwhelmed.
Yeah.
What's happening is that these kids on both sides are being cheated. The legal ones here and the illegal ones, nobody's getting a good education. You got classrooms here in Los Angeles, and I've been there, 30, 40 per teacher. You ain't got time to teach nobody. I happen to agree that you need an immersion. Mm-hmm. You need to learn the language. You know, I really do think, as I think about it,
the beauty of the United States is we don't have a culture. It's everyone's culture. The idea is don't bring your culture. We're not telling you to drop your religion. No. We're not telling you to drop your language or your cooking or whatever it is. But when you go out into the world, you have no culture.
Yeah,
and I think, first off, I think a lot of problems started when we started adding the American at the end of everything.
Yeah, true.
Mexican American, African American, Italian American. I think that's a problem.
That is a government problem. That started during the McCarthy era when all government forms, you have to identify yourself or your nationality, because that is a problem that started here. Nobody volunteered. Nobody volunteered that. That is a form that started. American Indian.
I feel like we ought to treat this place like a nudist camp.
Like a nudist camp.
Take your ceremonial garb off and show up at the pool, crack a beer, and play some volleyball.
Osvaldo.
If you're under 35, I don't want to see any 80-year-olds spiking a ball.
Hey, Osvaldo, he say to take your clothes off now.
No, you're misinterpreting what I'm saying. I don't want to see everyone walking around celebrating their culture and their ancestry
except
all the
on
time.
Their designated day. Look. And Saint
I don't
Patrick's
even
Day,
like that.
I'm Irish.
Yeah.
You know, during Martin Luther, you know, African American, I date exclusively white women to celebrate, you know, African American. Japanese, I go to Toyota tent sales. And I try to be multicultural and multilingual, you know, because, like, for example, during Mexican Cinco de Mayo, I'm down with the tequila. Mm-hmm. I'm down with all that. See, I think what I'm trying to poke light, but I think what you're saying is, it's all right to be proud of where you're from or where your ancestry is,
right?
But that's not what you are in the real world.
I'm saying show up, get nude, and get in the pool and crack a beer and shut up. That's basically what I'm telling people to do. And like I'm saying, when you leave your country behind, leave it behind. I'm not saying you have to come over here and start watching NASCAR and worshiping at the altar of Dr. Phil.
Rodeo?
But the language, the culture, you've come here, A, because something's wrong with your country. Please, everyone understand that very clearly. There's something incredibly wrong with your country. That's why you came here. Let's start from that point. Not that you come from some utopia and you've come over here to save our country. You've come here because something is wrong
because
with your country.
Because you were poor there. Because in any country, when you're rich, there's nothing wrong with that country.
Right. All right. I have more to say, but we're out of time.
Paul, I like the veins popping. You know,
I know. I'm fired up.
I never saw this fiery side. You know, that's going to be so wonderful when the twins come along and they have to, you know, their boyfriends or their girlfriends have to come by and ask permission from a elderly, NASCAR hat wearing.
Yes. Tobacco chewing. Paul Rodriguez is here.
Congratulations on your kids.
Thank you.
You know me? I am here for a political problem.
Right.
I no go now for political, for economic problem.
Yeah.
You didn't come here for economical problem.
No.
Yeah. But you brought $5,000 for me last week, so there's some economical problem.
He lent you $5,000?
Paul Rodriguez.
Adam, can I talk to you after the show? The career ain't doing well. I'm running around doing George Lopez impersonations now. let's be honest.
We'll take a quick break, and we'll be right back after
Thanks
this.
Thanks a lot, man.
Thanks.
Adam's wife has two buns in the oven. A result of the ace man's loving. He must have bionic sperm. Cause now they're bringing two babies to term.
Baby names, baby names.
Ed is on the phone from Las Vegas. He does our Desperate Housewives review for us every Monday. Ed?
Hey, Adam, how you doing?
Good, Ed. How you doing?
Oh, I'm doing pretty good.
Yes.
They having a Mexican parade later on, so.
Oh, really? That's going to be good.
I don't think
that's Yeah, it's a march. Anyway, I shouldn't have to explain to the man of color what a march is about against the man himself. But listen, speaking of brothers, you guys have it easy. You have kids. You just name the first five after you. Boy or girl, doesn't really matter. But for Whitey, we got trouble. I can't name my kid Adam or Adam Lena or whatever. I got to come up with interesting names.
Well, I told you earlier when I told you I like the name Edward, but I don't think you like that one.
Right, again.
I got some names. Mm-hmm. I like the name Nickel.
Nickel?
Yeah.
Nickel, like the alloy? Nickel?
No, like the money. Like the money. Right. No alloy. I don't know what alloy is. Nickel is money.
I understand. Okay. Nickel. All right. And then what do we name the girl? 50 Cent?
No, that was the girl.
Oh, that's a girl. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry. Nickel's a girl. Like, yeah, okay. Could people think it's short for Nicole or something. They'll be confused. But Nickel, and what about the boy?
Well, the boy name, I like Speed as the name.
Speed. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, because, I mean, I don't know how fast you are. Well, you, what are you? Well, you're not black, so you're probably not real fast. But he might have some speed to him. I like that name.
Well, yeah, I don't wasn't exactly known for my wheels, but Speed Carolla. It's not bad, but it'll be sadly ironic when he's the slowest kid in his class and then later on gets strung out on methamphetamines.
Well, that wouldn't be good. You don't want him to do that.
Yeah. So you got Speed and Nickel.
Well, there's a whole bunch of names you could name them. I mean,
but that's
more than just those two.
I see, it's more than just Speed and Nickel.
You don't want to name him like the Dave or the Brian or nothing like that.
Right. The guys,
you know,
the guys
regular
here.
Names.
Right. Yeah. You want something cool?
Well, yeah. You're Ace. You're a clever guy, but you've even said you'll let listeners name one of your two children.
Sure. Why not? I don't mind. All right, Ed. What do you say? How say you? You saw Desperate Housewives yesterday?
I say yes.
Yes, you did. And how was it?
It was a good show. You know, they brought the black people back this week.
Hmm.
But you know what happened?
Hmm.
They're moving. Because, mm-hmm. you know, they killed that white man, and they said they don't want to live in a house with murderers, so mm-hmm. they're moving.
Mm-hmm.
But that means they're living with themselves. I don't understand it.
Right. Right.
So they got to go. Mm-hmm. And so they might be moving. They got the house up for sale.
Mm-hmm.
Then the Gabriella, her and her husband, mm-hmm. they put the baby in one of the little buckets with the wheels on it. Mm-hmm. And they start walking him around the neighborhood so everybody can get a peek at him.
You're talking about a stroller? A carriage?
Yeah, one of them carriage babies.
Okay.
Yeah, they had that. And they would walk around the neighborhood, and some high school boy come up and say, "Ooh, that's a good-looking baby. I'd like to have it."
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
she said, "Well, you can't have this one. It's mine." Mm-hmm. And he said, "Well, I'm the baby's daddy."
Mm-hmm.
So we got a mess there. Mm-hmm. And he said he was going to take the baby. But the Gabriella husband stood up and said, "If you take him, I'm going to punch you in the nose."
Mm.
So the boy left.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Then the red-haired lady, her uh-huh. and her friend, she got a friend that helped her stop drinking.
Mm-hmm.
They stopped drinking, but they went to a sex party.
Mm.
And they opened the door. They was naked people everywhere. Well, they didn't show them because they don't show that. They got to watch HBO for that.
Yeah.
But they didn't have it on the CBS.
Mm-hmm.
So they left it on there. And they walked out.
And what about Lois?
Who?
Lois of Lois and Clark, Lois Lane.
Oh, you know what happened with her?
Terry Hatcher, yeah.
Yeah. She, her husband broke up with his girlfriend. Now the girlfriend wants to go with Lois.
Mm-hmm.
So they went and had a couple of drinks, and they went to a bar, and they got in a fight with a bunch of other girls.
Mm-hmm.
Lesbian bar.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it was. It was a cat fight, though.
Mm-hmm.
They was all ripping each other's clothes, and I rewound that one like three times. That
sure.
Part.
Sure.
I said, look at them girls go. I said, look at them.
Yeah.
I watched it last night with you know, the lady I've been seeing. She came over and we watched it
from down the hall. She lives in your apartment.
She lived down the hall. She lived down two apartment doors down.
Her husband passed away, right?
Right.
Yeah, he died. Somebody shot him.
Oh, really?
A murder?
Yeah. Yeah, he got. Well, I don't know if it was a murder, but somebody shot him.
Huh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so now she's alone.
Mm-hmm.
I'm alone.
Right.
And we watched the show together.
Yeah. You're alone together.
Sure. The ad's there to pick up the pieces.
Well, she got kids, though. It'll make it difficult. She's only 26.
Wow. Really? Wow.
And she's 26. She's got four kids. They all live at home with her.
So it's got to be tough humping someone when you're rubbing up against kids.
The Ed, how old a man are you? You've got four grown boys.
I'm 54.
Mm-hmm.
And you're getting a 26-year-old.
Nice.
I don't like them old girls. They turn 40, you got to trade them in for two 20s.
I see. You make change.
Yeah,
trade in that dime for two nickels.
Oh, yeah. I like that name, Nickel.
Yeah, I know you do. I brought it all full circle. Thanks, the Ed. We appreciate the Desperate Housewives update.
Okay.
Nice work. And I'll keep Speed and Nickel in mind. Speed's for the boy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I figured if Nickel was for the boy, because then the girl could be Penny.
Oh, yeah. That would work, but it'd give her an inferiority complex.
I guess that's true.
He loves me five times as much. All right, we will talk to Deaf Frat Guy. He's sitting in. He's going to do the news.
Dude, I've been here since 6 a.m.
Yeah, I know. That's how it works. Look, you want to work in morning radio, you have to set your alarm, you have to get up early, and you have to show up, and you hang out all day.
But, dude, I don't hang out all day. I'm out in the hallway.
No, I know, but it's... this is how it works. I'm sensing a little attitude. You wanted to break into morning radio. You have to get up. You have to get dressed. You have to show up just like everybody.
But I do that all the time, and all I get are empty promises.
Okay. Well, I don't think you should be laughing at him, Brisket.
Empty promises.
We'll take ourselves a break. When we come back, it's your time to shine. You'll be doing the news.
Hell yeah.
After this.
Maverick. Can't hear much, but he can still drink beer and party every day. Well, he likes chicks, sorority girls are always ready to play. Well, Moose gets Woody at the drop of a hat, but he says that he ain't bi. Just a fifth-year senior living it up, hearing loss ain't a crime. He's a deaf rat guy. Maverick. Deaf rat guy. Chick. Deaf rat guy. Mm-hmm.
Deaf Rat Guy's in studio.
What's up, bro?
Pull the mic up to your pie hole there, Deaf Rat Guy.
What's up, bro?
Thanks. Maverick is sitting in. He's going to be doing news for us today. Did a great job in the 7 o'clock hour. And I don't see any reason that trend is not going to continue right through the 9 o'clock hour. So, without any further ado,
Here's Maverick, deaf frat guy, with the news.
Organizers predict unprecedented participation in today's rallies against a proposed crackdown on illegal immigration.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any Latinos in the teak house over there at SC?
Negative.
All right, Mav. Keep going.
The British tabloids say Tom Cruise and Katie Holmes are getting married on July 1st.
How interested can we be in two people? I guess the world may never know, but you know what I mean? And are we just interested because other people are talking about it? Is anyone really that concerned?
Well, I always wonder about it. It's the same thing with NASCAR's popularity, Celine Dion's. I don't know anyone who likes these things, but someone creates the market for this fascination with Cruise and Holmes. Who gives a crud?
Yes. All right. I'm with you.
Dude, he's only the best pilot in the history of moving.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Oh, we forgot. Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry, Maverick. You're named after him. For
name's sake.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Why do we care about him? He's only the best pilot ever.
Sorry.
I thought that was Iceman.
I do get a little bummed out when Tom Cruise talks about him not liking when people get wasted.
Yeah. Yeah, that must be a very...
Here's the problem. You don't know the history of psychiatry. I do.
Thank goodness deaf rat guy couldn't hear that.
Yeah, he would have been very disappointed. Sorry, go ahead, Maverick.
Barbara Walters made the big announcement Friday night at the Daytime Emmys that Rosie O'Donnell will be replacing Meredith Vieira on The View.
I am gay. I'm a lesbian. I'm a homosexual gay lesbian.
Yeah. I'd make jokes about it, but really, what could I say that hasn't already been said? That's going to be great. It's going to be fun watching her and Star go at it, and the wheels come off the wagon. Mm-hmm. And that is going to be a battle of the super heavyweights, too. Not only physically super heavyweights, but in the C department, you guys do the word. It's going to be great to see those two bisons locking antlers every morning. I will watch.
Well, the good-looking young one, she's going to get caught in the crossfire there, too. Well, she's, but you know, Star and Rosie are both pretty liberal women.
Mm-hmm.
The other one, you know, the good-looking one, she's far right.
Hasselbeck's far right.
Oh, yeah, she's going to get brutalized. Yeah, she's awful.
Wow, steamroll. Dave, how do you know, by the way?
Because she talks incessantly about, girls I know told me, good Christ, I'm gay.
Sorry, man. Go ahead.
The Supreme Court ruled Monday that one-time stripper Anna Nicole Smith could pursue part of her late husband's oil fortune.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I think she deserves it. She married the guy.
Her late husband's estate has been estimated at as much as $1.6 billion.
Wow, that is a lot of oil money.
Dude, that is ducats, bro.
Yeah, man, you could buy the imported beer with that kind of dough.
Dude, what do you think of her, though?
Dude, she's super hot now that she did the trim spa.
Mm-hmm.
Mike F. likes her when she was heavier.
Mm-hmm. Huh.
And I'm like, dude, she looked like a manatee.
Right.
But he's like, dude, unless you've been with a fat chick, don't knock it until you're trying it.
He has a weird cadence, that Mike F. So he liked her. He's a chubby chaser, Mike F. is.
Dude, Mike F. will hit anything with two holes in a heartbeat.
So Mike F. liked the hefty version, and you like the thinner version now.
I like a chick that looks like Misha Barton.
Right. like a nice thin one. Yeah. And also, she seems more lucid now as well. Seems like she's off the drugs.
I wanted to ask you, Ace, speaking of good-looking girls, you were on Kimmel on Friday night, and the surprise guest that night was Kelly Pickler on the show.
Mm-hmm.
You took a seat next to her. What do you think of her?
She is attractive and exactly what she looks like on TV, but a little bit smaller than you picture her. And here's the thing that is weird. I was thinking about it, and this is why most of the chicks that end up on TV end up with an eating disorder. I saw her ass a couple of times on American Idol when she was in tight jeans, and I remember commenting to my wife, well, she's got a little junk in the trunk. You see her in real life. She's a pixie. The fact is, this is why these women have eating disorders that are on TV, is they're not big women. I mean, she's five. She told me she was 5'1", maybe 5'2", and she's maybe 105, maybe 110 pounds. You see her on TV. She sees herself on TV. She says, I got a decent size ass. I got to shrink that. Well, how do you shrink it? You're already underweight. You start throwing up and stop eating altogether. This is how it works.
When Moose was going out with Ashley,
right,
he said the reason why they broke up is because she had a little junk in the trunk. She says that he went like quick draw McGraw, right. But now he's been dissing her, and now she's coming back to say that she wanted, he wanted.
Oh, we got bleeped for that. He wanted a digital rectal stimulation, is what you were saying.
But what I'm saying, it's not true. There's no way Moose would do that. He's not like that.
Well, so says you. Andre?
Yes.
Andre, do you have names for my kids, by the way?
Yeah, I have one for your son.
Go ahead.
Sargento Carolla.
Sargento. Ah.
Yes.
Sarge.
It's kind of nice. You go Sarge for short. It sounds very Italian. Sargento Carolla. Yeah, that's nice.
Picture this. Mm. First day of kindergarten. You know, he comes in. He has like the Robin Hood hat on with the feather in it. You know, he kind of glides in the door, and the teacher sticks out her hand and says, you know, my name is this Crabtree. What's your name? He flips her hand over and removes the cap on one hand, bends down, and says, I'm Sargento. Kisses her hand and replaces the hat and says, Sargento Carolla.
I like that. All right. Thank you. I'll write down Sargento. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mav. I'm sorry for getting away from your news. Go ahead.
I'm Maverick. That's the news. Remember, if you're not waiting, today is.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
I was with the guy on the whole Sargento thing. What, the Robin Hood hat with the feather in on the first day of school? I'm not sure what that accomplished.
I think he was looking for sort of the native Italian look. I'm sure he sort of mixed things up just a little bit with his Sheriff of Nottingham crap. Right, but
my comments will be brief in hopes that you'll explain to all of us how you'll handle your child if he does turn out to be gay.
Okay.
But now I will talk about the great days that we're living in. Los Angeles, pro basketball. Mm-hmm. It couldn't be any better.
Mm-mm.
Yesterday, great game. A game for the ages. Kobe Bryant ties it down 2 points. Smush Parker steals the ball from the supposed MVP, Steve Nash. Kobe makes a fantastic floater, sends it to overtime, then down one in the waning seconds of overtime. You get Kobe to make to get the ball, drive it to the foul line, and then this.
A one-point game. Walton can tip it. Bryant with the save.
Now you got to get a shot here.
Final seconds. Bryant for the win.
An awesome scene, and as I said earlier, I watched it with 100 people of all different races and creeds standing in the mall, people cheering as one for the adulterous multimillionaire.
Talk about insightful color commentary when the guy said, you got to get a shot here. Yeah, there's two and a half seconds left in the game, and you're down by a point. I think going into the four corner at that point would be out of the question. I agree.
Yes, a good point. But the Lakers' victory puts them up 3-1 against the Suns in the series. And on Saturday night, the Clippers beat Denver. Now they're up 3-1. So we are getting very close to a Lakers-Clippers playoff series. That's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Whatever side you fall down on, and I assume most fall down on the side of the Lakers with this, but yeah, as I've said before, I know I always castigate everyone who's from Chicago, and they like the Cubs and the White Sox. I've always said, choose. You don't get to have both. Right. In this case, I choose to root for both Lakers and Clippers. It's expensive to live here.
I agree.
I deserve to have two
basketball
teams.
You should get two teams, and plus, we don't have a football team, so give us our two basketball teams.
More good rationalizing.
I would be more interested, though, in finding out if anyone on the Lakers or the Clippers knew what their team's name meant.
Well, we did find out that the Clippers, almost to a man, have no idea what a Clipper is.
Right.
Yeah, the Lakers question is a good one, too. Chris Kaman pulled it out, though. He did know that it was a,
a
fast-moving boat.
People know what a lake is, but I'm not sure if they know the origins of the Minnesota thing.
Interesting. Yes, we should research that. Now, on to the NFL draft this weekend. Didn't go very well for USC. All the big-name guys. Reggie Bush passed over for North Carolina State defensive end Mario Williams.
Sorry,
as I said before. Retarded.
They'll get what they deserve.
Okay, you're giving the potato
I'm talking
gun.
About the owners that passed up the SC players.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was too bad. Matt Leinart fell to 10th. He went to Arizona. Probably a good situation with all those good wide receivers, but he would have been the number one pick last year.
Mav, I don't want to see you going home hot-headed and going for the potato gun and doing something stupid and getting yourself into trouble.
The thing, I'm not saying I'm going to do this, but let's just say maybe a potato gun could be smuggled into an NFL stadium.
Oh, my God. It'd be like Black Sunday.
So who's the victim, though? I mean, who's the target?
The GM.
Oh, I see. I didn't know in
what's
the stadium
this?
Who you were taking out.
What's this? It's just some Aquanet. I like to keep my hair neat. I have a lighter because I smoke,
right?
And I like to have potatoes during the game.
Don't give away all your secrets.
Yes.
This tube is for me to yell.
Yeah, like day. It'd be like Day of the Jackal. Maverick's up there in the cheap seats. He's sitting there with his binoculars. He comes in there with a limp, using a cane, then quickly starts undoing it and putting together his very accurate potato gun.
The bowels of the stadium he's doing.
Now
with
he has the GM from the Texans in his crosshairs.
In the old days, all they had to worry about was getting Gatorade dumped on their head.
That's right.
Now they have to worry about getting shot with a potato.
Once again, though, let's rehearse this very quickly. Hey, why do you have the Aquanet?
I like to keep my hair neat.
I like that.
And there's a lot of wind on the field.
I see.
I play Sarge Justice, a disgraced LAPD cop who has to stop him. He's the only one who believes that frat guy's coming in to make the hit on the new team. We have finally got the Los Angeles Rams back. It's the year 2025. I have to stop the hit. I'm running in slow motion as he's getting the GM of the Texans in his crosshairs.
What? Is it a crime to bring in a bag of potatoes?
All right. Sorry. Go ahead, Chuck.
Talk about national pastime quickly. Dodgers blew one yesterday in San Diego. They were up 5 in the ninth inning. They lose it next three, 6-5. Halos got swept by the White Sox. Arizona dumped by the Giants. M's beat the O's. A's beat the Royals of KC.
Now, and you know what their combined record, by the way, is? Those five teams you've just mentioned? 63-63. That's the combined record of the five teams.
All right.
Why do we need so many goddamn games?
All right, Commie. What?
All
that
right.
Frat guy has something to say.
I just want to say Matt Leinart may be bummed out a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is that dude gets more tang than a Shanghai phone book.
Thank you.
Reality check.
Yeah.
Now, I just want to quickly go over, before we move on, to the best names I saw in the NFL draft this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of great names, in fact. I didn't even, like I mentioned Santonio Holmes already of the Steelers. Definitely a front runner for definitely not a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
First name Santonio, 22 years of age, 3 children.
Yeah.
Probably not Jewish.
Yeah.
Now, also,
It is funny. A little cultural difference between perhaps the Jews and the brother man. It is funny to see 19, 20, and 21-year-old guys explaining, look, they got to leave. They got families to support. You think, but you're a junior, you're a sophomore in college. What do you mean you have a family? Oh, you're talking about your mother is on disability? No, I got my own family.
So you're taking care of your mother. Oh, no, you actually have children of your own.
That's right. Imagine you, sophomore in Indiana. With a bunch of kids.
Pucci, definitely not a Jew.
Is that right? Why?
He's not. He's Italian.
Oh,
yeah, it's not funny.
It's not the same.
It's not a joke. Not everything's funny.
Also, I didn't even consider DeQuell Jackson didn't make the list. The
DeQuell.
Winston Justice, awesome name.
Ooh,
but
good.
didn't make the cut. Deuce Latouille, again of USC. Now, let's move on to the good name, to the really good names.
Mm-hmm.
Green Bay drafted linebacker Ohio State, A.J. Hawk.
Strong for a linebacker.
Dynamite.
Swooping down on
quarterbacks. The Bears took from Ohio State, Ashton Yabuti.
Yabuti!
Now, how about this one? The Giants took an offensive lineman, Guy Wimper. I admire him for overcoming that hindrance of a name.
Yeah.
Guy Wimper.
Yeah.
Could you do worse than that? And he made it all the way to the NFL.
Well, you could go Dick Butkus.
Yeah, that's true.
Or even Dick Trickle.
Now, the worst, the best name.
Mm-hmm.
Not just this season, but I think in the last many seasons. Mm. The New York Jets first round pick, offensive lineman, DeBrickashaw Ferguson.
DeBrickashaw.
DeBrickashaw.
Wow. That is solid.
Also, definitely not a Jew.
Yes.
But some name, huh? DeBrickashaw Damashek.
Yes. Put that in the hopper. All right, we need to take ourselves a break. Mav, nice job with the news, buddy.
It's all good, bro. Can I say one more thing?
Yes, quickly.
You said you'd hire me. Oh, this guy here, he did.
Brisket, yeah.
It's time to crap or get off the pot.
I see. Okay. Hot ultimatums this morning.
I'm here all the time.
Okay, just relax. Just relax. I think this newfound celebrity is going to Maverick's head. We'll take a quick break. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about getting fired, getting hired, getting ass canned from your gig. Perhaps it's something that's going to happen to Maverick very shortly. We'll be right back after this.
This is really easy. You're fired. You're fired. You're fired.
You're fired.
Don't smoke.
You're fired.
Smoking, smoking, smoking sucks.
This is really easy.
Don't smoke.
You're fired.
Is this the Trump montage? Yeah, I like it. Yeah. Don't smoke and you're fired. Jonathan Groff is here. Annabelle Gurwitch is here. I'm sorry, Annabelle. Did I call you Annabella?
I like that, though.
Yeah, it's kinda... give it a little Italian flair.
Yeah.
Fired Again, name of the book we're talking about. These are stories that are compiled of famous folks that have been S-can throughout their life. Annabelle started by getting fired by Woody Allen.
That's true. Woody, I was hired to do a play that he was directing and writing. And after, I mean, I knew it was going badly. He was looking at me like drop dead. But what he actually said was, you seem retarded when you do that.
Wow.
Yeah. And the problem was my character was not supposed to be retarded. Because, you know, that can actually playing someone mentally handicapped can win you an Academy Award.
Sure.
You know? But unfortunately, my character was not at all supposed to be mentally impaired. So clearly it wasn't going well. And, you know.
And he fired you.
Well, yeah, I got the call that you get in show business. You know, you don't get fired. You get like, we're going in a different direction, which means we want to get as far away from you as is physically possible.
And so that sort of inspired you to compile these tales of people being fired.
Right. After a lot of drinking, being depressed, depression. Trying to throw myself in front of traffic, the next step was to like ask all my comedian friends if they had been fired. And the outpouring of insanely unbelievable stories of everything from like Paul Feig fired as the Ronald McDonald of Toledo, Ohio. Matt Walsh from UCB fired while he was a singing telegram artist in Chicago. He was, you know.
How about Sarah? I'm looking at Sarah Silverman's name here.
Fired by fax from SNL. Actually, no, they faxed her agent. They didn't even fax her.
Wow. Tim Allen, what'd he get fired
what
from?
What hasn't he been fired from?
Well, that's probably a good point.
No, he was fired from Tool and Die, fired as a busboy. This actual story is about being fired when he was working as a DJ. And so, yeah, I compiled all these stories. Bob Saget was once doing a morning talk show, and he gets to work one day, and the chair that says Bob on it is just gone. Just completely gone.
Yeah, it's weird. There's not a whole lot of etiquette for firing. Sorry for leaving you out of the conversation, Jonathan.
No, okay. I was going to get to Jonathan Groff. Fired for maybe being too taller than John Stewart?
I don't know. It's a theory. Listen, I was a writer at the John Stewart Show back when it was on MTV.
Yes.
A long time ago. Remember that
Sure.
One?
And, you know, I noticed that I was the tallest guy in the staff, and I was the first guy to get fired. And John's not a tall guy. And I actually heard this from somebody else who'd gone in for an interview and goes, I'm not going to get the job because I tower over him. So I had that in the back of my mind.
Yeah, no one wants to look up and yell at people simultaneously. Exactly. Like, you don't want to have your head tilted up at a 45-degree angle calling, you call this funny? I wipe my ass with this crap. No, you want to look down and yell.
Absolutely. So he would stand on a chair and scream at me. Now, there was justification for firing me, in which that I sucked as a writer. So,
right. Well, you're the former head writer with Late Night with Conan O'Brien. Well, it couldn't have been that bad.
Well, that's my theory. That sort of supports my theory, is because like 6 months after being fired by John, I got hired as a staff writer by Conan O'Brien, who's 6'4". It kind of towers over me. And maybe he could tell me I suck from a higher altitude and make him happy.
See, you know, that it is a theory. But see, what I really like about these stories is that, you know, people entertain in this book the idea that they sucked. Like Bill Maher says he sucked on his first show that he was the host of. You said you might have sucked, you know, on Jon Stewart's show. I sucked in that Woody Allen play. I think it's really good to stand up and say, hey, I sucked. It's very liberating. And it's very great for other people to see people who have had success in show business. You know, it's very, you know, humanizing to know that other people fail. Successful people fail.
And successful people, I think, try, on a serious note, to get something out of the fact that they're fired, not just explain the boss has it in for me. They try to figure out why they were fired and maybe not make the same mistake again.
Exactly. Well, sometimes you deserve to get fired, and it's worth, like, figuring out what you did wrong.
Yeah, I mean, you know, look, a lot of people find this book very inspiring. You know, I people say, like, well, it's like a lemons into lemonade. I'm like, yeah, it's a very bitter lemonade, though. I mean, let's face it. You know, it's a crappy, you know, character building experience to get fired. But it's true. A lot of people find, you know, a lot of lessons in being fired, and there are things to learn. I mean, Andy Borowitz, fired from The Facts of Life. He was told he was the worst writer on kind of what was the
on
worst
on The Facts of
on
Life,
the worst TV show ever. But here's the great part of the story, right? So he's told the whole time he's on The Facts of Life, don't be like this guy Paul. Paul's the worst writer ever. Don't be like Paul. Well, this guy Paul, who was fired right before Andy from The Facts of Life, was Paul Haggis, who won 2 Academy Awards now for Million Dollar Baby and for Crash. So, you know, you don't want to be like that guy.
Well, we were told, when I say we, I mean me and Jimmy Kimmel, that turned out to be a fairly successful comedy team. When we started doing radio, we were forbidden from working together on the radio. We were told you guys can never be together on the radio. A lot of that was for the scatological direction we would go in, but they took Jimmy and I, who later on became a good comedy team. You'll not work together. You'll not be working together. You guys are no good together. And I was told, I don't know if I ever told this to Jimmy, but hey, buddy, if you're listening now, I was told that Jimmy was a behind the scenes guy, not the kind of guy who should be out in front of the camera.
It's things like that, like that are in this book that I think, I mean, I've been getting all these letters from people all over the country saying, thank you. I don't feel like such a failure because I was fired. Like some guy called me last week on a radio show and said, I read your book. It made me feel good because I was fired for passing gas in an office with no windows. And I was, you know, so, or someone actually, she wrote me a letter saying, I was fired because my boss called me in and asked me to trim his nasal hairs. And after reading your book, I just know there's going to be something better for me out there. So,
hey, Brasco, hold on. Find the guy who was fired for beefing in the office space. Get him in here. Tad, you're out. The guy breaks wind. This is the kind of, I would like to have a sort of halfway house for people that were fired for breaking wind in the workspace. We need to take a break. We'll talk more about this in just a moment.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Yeah, we don't need to play that one at the end of the show, I would say. But we have a few more valuable minutes. Fire Bill, the board guy, would you? Annabelle Gurwitch is here. Jonathan Groff is both here talking about Fired Again, which is the stage version of Fired, Tales of the Canned. Canceled, downsized, and dismissed.
Yeah, actually, that whole thing is the title of the book. When I pitched it to Simon & Schuster when they bought the book, I said it should just be called crappy jobs that ended poorly, but for some reason it became much more like complicated than that. But we are doing the show live in LA this week. We have 5 shows. They asked me to give out the number 310-827-0889. It's at the Skirt Ball, and actually we've got shows that are going across the country. You know, how does the show work? People who've written essays in the book, or people who've written like for the night. Like this week I have Jonathan Groff's doing it, Scott Carter, Bill Maher's producer, mm-hmm. who actually was fired from the softcore porn industry.
Wow.
He had hoped
he's
to.
He's hung, huh?
Yeah. He was on the other side. He had
wrote
hoped,
softcore porn.
He did. He did. He had hoped to join like the New York literary pantheon of writers, but instead found himself deep in the valley writing porn, and he was fired for trying to write porn in iambic pentameter, trying to elevate the art. That didn't work out. And Carol Leifer is going to be performing this week. Jeff Kahn from The Ben Stiller Show. Rob Cohn.
To me, the thing about softcore porn is it's all in the title. I mean, if you give me a bad title, I'm not going to watch it. If you give me a good title, once in a while there's like a cave bikini girls, or you know, busty D-cup patrol or something. I'm always fascinated and interested in that. If it's sort of boring, just the Emmanuel stuff, I'm not interested.
Or like
it's,
Lusty Nights. You're not going to show up for Lusty Nights.
Yes, no, not too generic. Yeah. Yes.
No, might as well go right straight for the hardcore. I mean, why bother with like the...
Well, you know, it's weird, but as I get a little bit older, maybe I'm just waxing nostalgic in my underpants, but I like to think about... That's going to be the name of my book. I like to think back to a simpler time. I sort of like the softcore stuff. It sort of brings us back to more innocent time. That's all.
You should try to get Scott Carter to collaborate
write me a porn.
On it.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Mav?
I just want to say, you should write a book called Hired and give it to Jimmy Brodka, because I need to be hired. I'm coming in all the time.
Okay, that's enough.
Adam, have you ever been fired? I have to ask you that.
Well, let's see. I've worked at McDonald's, but I think I quit that gig. The thing, I always worked as a carpenter, and when you're a carpenter, the jobs last about 3 weeks or 5 weeks, and then you start looking for another job. I think I may have got fired from a liquor store delivery job for overloading the wagon with booze. The bumper was dragging on the new wagon, and I remember getting yelled at for that. I thought I was a hero for getting it all in one run when I went down to the liquor depot to pick it up, but I got yelled at by the 8-foot Jewish man who used to work there. That's probably fired from the flask liquor store. In Studio City.
You know, D.L. Hughley actually has a story in my book. D.L. was fired from McDonald's for eating one too many Egg McMuffin, and it's like really kind of haunted him his whole life now, because he can't go into a McDonald's. He had kids. He had to like wait in the car because just too traumatizing.
Well, D.L. should have done what I did, which is I would volunteer to throw away the food that sat too long. Once in a while, some softball team would get overzealous and order 10 Big Macs and 5 Filet-O-Fish, and then never pick them up. And if they sat for more than 55 minutes, they had to be thrown away. I would volunteer to do that and then sit there like a raccoon by the dumpster and see how many of these things I could simultaneously put in my mouth and keister before people would get suspicious and I had to head back on to my grill shift.
Well, now, didn't you pass into some kind of coma after eating all that?
I was not going to throw away good food, and the fact that I made that burger 55 minutes earlier didn't mean it was wrong. It wasn't bad.
Good food? Let's talk about
it. Actually, you know what DL said? He actually really was totally crushed when he was fired from that job, because he said like the uniform was a babe magnet.
Oh, yeah.
So he had to like keep wearing, he said, you know,
well,
that he kept wearing that like little paper hat and the little uniform for months after that, just to pick up women.
Well, yes. I mean, women love brown polyester, but I'll tell you the other thing that turns them on is they would tell you couldn't wear tennis shoes at McDonald's back, and they didn't want any rubber-soled shoes.
Why?
They didn't think it looked good with the uniform. You had the brown slacks and the brown gi on. They didn't want to see you with the white Converse on. I had to wear the shoes that I wore to my 9th grade graduation, my ill-fitting leather Fred McMurray-type shoes for my 3 sons sliding all over the floors I was mopping in. I should do a chapter in your book. I'm fired up now.
You know what? I'm recalling the book. We're going to add stories.
Addendum.
Absolutely.
All right. We are plumb out of time. Annabelle, Jonathan, thank you very much. Fired Again is the name of the show. You can see it at the Skirball Center coming up Wednesday through Saturday.
out here.
Wednesday through Sunday.
Oh.
Even one more show, Adam. We'll stick you in it. Just come tell your story.
And Fired, the name of the book.
That's right.
Thanks.
Right. All right. You want to talk us off the air, Mav?
Coming up tomorrow, porn star Sunset Thomas, comedian Harlan Williams, and Seth MacFarlane. And I want to thank Paul Rodriguez. He's at the Laugh Factory, 11 a.m. to 10 p.m. A Day Without an Immigrant is the name of the show. Annabelle Gurwitch and Jonathan Groff, thank you. Their book, Fired, and the show is called Fired Again, Wednesday through Saturday at the Scarborough Cultural Center. Also, I want to thank Ozzy and to give a shout out to all my peeps at the T-Gown. What's up?
All right. Well, until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.